computer. Hey, so how was your day today? Is this the end of a very long day for you guys?
Yes.
Oh, really?
Long, like 3 weeks.
Well, but you had vacation though, didn't you?
I live in a house with two teenage girls.
Are you one of them?
No. I'm the almost teenage, but I don't have shouting matches with my sisters over shirts.
Yeah, we had a altercation in my house today. hopefully there'll be no spillover. But you never know. Right, so for me, it's really like Macbeth, tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow, every day is the same. You know, I mean, I'm not enjoying it, but I have time. It's horrible, but I do have time to do things that I want to do, which is nice.
It really does feel like that.
So you guys have been, you people have been studying all day today for the past 8 hours. Oh my God.
Since eight.
So what do you want? What do you want to do right now? Then you probably just like want to lie down or something.
This is my first class of the day. I'm ready to go.
Jeez.
you're ready for go. It's mine also.
Sorry, dolls.
My first class of the week. We professors, wow. We're definitely underpaid, aren't we?
Yeah. I mean, I've had a 4 hour break from 12 to now.
What do you do with your breaks?
Eat.
Eat is a good one, right? Where is the chat part? Oh, here's the chat part. Oh, is it somebody's birthday?
Mm-hmm. C's
birthday was yesterday. Oh wow! Did you bring a cake? See, where is he?
You want my chocolate? I'll give you a virtual chocolate.
I wish we can we find a way of sharing on Zoom?
Work on it.
That's the next technology.
I'll patent chocolate teleportation.
I mean, that seems like the kind of thing that would get us to invent a teleporter.
Right. I think Zahavit was thinking along those lines, right? You were all Star Trek on that one, right?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, we've already got the video communicators. It's the next thing.
Okay. So, does anybody else want to share a little bit about their week or their vacation? Is there a distinction between vacation and school, or?
Well, I have to get up a lot earlier when I have school.
Right. Are you glad to go back or to come back or to?
It's nice to have a schedule. It's
deeply.
It's hard to concentrate.
I will be so glad when we can come back to the actual university.
I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon.
Yeah. I'm glad we got classes again.
About what you were saying about the eating. I just received something. An average panda, I have no battery. Average panda spends at least 12 hours a day eating. So does an adult in quarantine. This is why it's called pandemic.
No joke, though. Mr. Adebriud is doing a Zoom on weight loss because the average adult gained 5 kilo during this quarantine.
Is that right?
Just crazy. That's a lot of weight.
5 to 7. Well, there's nowhere to exercise. Like, you can't do anything.
I exercise every day.
You know what?
There's a will, there's a way, guys.
Shani, maybe you should do like.
That's a terrible thing to say.
Can you do an inspirational podcast for us, Sean?
No, I'm not inspirational.
I do a 5 kilometer walk every day around my house. I walk for an hour.
You go out. But also, even without leaving the house.
It's only about 300 meters. I go around and around the block.
But also, even without leaving the house, there is tons of things. Of ways to work out. Like what? Well, there's YouTubes of exercises, for example. If you don't have like a machine at home, there's things through the internet, a whole bunch of things.
Yeah.
They're really fun.
Guys, don't underestimate how heavy your body weight is, even if when you're working out. Body weight exercises are really useful.
buy a dog. That's what we did. And you get to take the dog. And then it's an obligation and you have to take the dog out.
I tried to convince my wife of that. She wasn't game.
Yeah.
But professor, they're not really enforcing the restriction in Tel Aviv. At least not along the shoreline, the Tel Aviv-Jaffa shoreline.
So what is that like, actually? Are people observing social distancing? Are they being smart about it, or is it just like usual?
The people are afraid of each other.
Good. Okay. So that's good. The bad thing is if people relax the restrictions and then they say, oh, we're all good, yalla, right? I mean, I think that's the bigger temptation. Mm-hmm. So
yeah. Let's go back to shul.
Right. Well, that's in my neighborhood. So, but they haven't done
that. I mean, it's here too. They had to weld shut 5 synagogues.
I saw that. Right.
Yeah.
Someone in my neighborhood did a bar mitzvah last week. There was no social distancing. I can tell you that.
So. Really? Oh my God.
Where do you live, Zavi?
Mishkafayim, Beit Shemesh. And like, nobody's that crazy here. So.
It's the normal part of Beit Shemesh?
It's in the normal part of Beit Shemesh.
Semi-normal.
That will say something. It's semi-normal, but that says something.
You know, Professor, I live very close to Bnei Brak, and I can tell you that even in Bnei Brak, the Haredim, they have internalized the restriction, and they follow.
I wouldn't say that that's true. As someone who lives like next to the bridge, it's definitely, there's 4 minyanim outside our house on a regular basis.
Yeah, they're in Bnei Brak, and they have stuff a lot.
All right, there are outliers, but I mean, in my neighborhood, people now look at the mask as kind of like a fashion statement, like they hold it in their hand or they put it on their chin or they put it on their head. It's like, no, it's meant to be on your face, right? Yeah. I asked some guy, where's your mask this morning? I'm trying to train myself not to have any communication with people in my neighborhood, but he said it was at home. I was like, okay, right? But having said that, I think Haredim, they do follow directions. Right. And once they're told, I mean, I see the eyes rolling as well. And I hear that. But I think there is some sense where people are still following directions on some level. I mean, whatever. I mean, I understand. It's not entirely. Chaya, what's your experience in Bayit Vegan? That people are following directions? We live in the same neighborhood. We never see each other.
I know, because I'm further down. And yeah. It's very different. No, here in Ramat, Ramat Hashel. But... we have I live in, like, on one side, it's like a house, but on the other side, it's like a building. Mm. And we've been having a minyan mirpasot, so that's been really, really beautiful. Really.
What have you been having?
Minyan mirpasot of the terrace.
Right.
And that's been really, really nice. However, on the lower level where he has a big garden, now they're davening there, they're praying there. Mm. And without masks. My husband still prays up here because they don't respect, like I know it's hard to have to wear a mask. Mm. My husband is a doctor and he has to wear it all day long and it's very difficult, but that's what it has to be. It's very hard. Especially as a doctor, it's very, very hard.
My husband,
he's a gynecologist and he works in emergency and every, like, he's for so many hours there, and some people just, like, at the beginning of the pandemic, the women would come with their husbands and the husband would coughing and everything. My husband had so many fights. He had to kick everyone out, put a whole bunch of barriers, and he goes all messed up from head to toe, but other people don't. Like, he works on the 8th floor, and since the pure beginning, I told him that really he couldn't take the elevator. Uh-huh. And that's very important, not to take elevators, by the way.
Can you imagine if you lived in Manhattan, right, what that would be like?
Well, can you understand why it spread out so quickly? It's normal.
Right.
But if
New Yorkers don't take it seriously.
Huh?
No. New Yorkers aren't. I don't know.
Well, New Yorkers don't take it seriously? New Yorkers don't take it
seriously? Well, they didn't, because, I mean, the spread of the pandemic there, it was the fastest spread. It's the worst part of the United States by far. So I think
so overcrowded.
Yeah.
We just, people everywhere, so it's going to spread faster.
Right. Did you guys hear about those spring breakers in Florida? They were called American college students.
Yeah, and a bunch.
If I catch it, then I catch it.
A bunch of different states are reopening. Also, ridiculous.
Do you feel safe in Israel, relatively?
Yeah, it's safer.
Yeah,
so much safer.
It is the safest country. They say it's the safest country.
Yeah, no, it's a survey that BB was pushing. I saw that.
My family in Spain, it's crazy. It's a disaster. What they did there, it's crazy. And also, they could have stopped it way before. So, comparatively, Israel really has done it very, very good.
See, what does the birthday boy have to say? See? How old are you?
Israel is, we are impatient and very aggressive and very hot blood, and I feel like the roads in the streets are safer now. You're less likely to be run over or get hit by someone.
That's really the bright side.
It's not even sarcastic. I experienced that now.
Statistically, he's right. Yeah.
Okay, I forgot to get some water. I'm gonna get some water and then we'll do some Milton. Okay, hold on a second.
Right.
Just before we start, I'm kind of asking you a version of how our classes. Is it harder to connect with literature now? I know that for you there's all the extrinsic stuff, meaning the class stuff and having to work, having to be there and take notes and all of that. But I'm sure that's very, very difficult. But just in terms of connecting with literature, is that something that you're able to do now? Is it more easy? Is it more difficult?
I think it's more easy, actually. It's because there's nothing going on.
Right.
So, more than I've ever written.
Who is that?
Me too.
Who's writing more than they're
Sean and Ben.
Really?
Shawnee and me, yeah.
That's in the creative writing program.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's also nice to have a break from screens, like to have something to do that's not a screen, because like my whole day is on screens and I do homework on screens, and it's nice to like look at something that's not a screen.
On a screen.
Yeah.
I haven't had internet for 7 days.
Wow. Jeez.
How did that happen?
So.
You should.
Oh, Bezek is a terrible company, is how that happened. But.
Wow. Oh, I thought you did it on purpose.
Oh, believe me. No. But I've been getting a lot done because of that. There's nowhere to go, and there's.
Congratulate you.
No. None in order.
Anybody else want to weigh in on that question about the literary? Is it just business as usual, or is it a little bit different?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi, Sammy. I wanted to say, I don't want to be a bummer, but like I lost my job, and like living situation is not easy, because like we had to leave our apartment because we couldn't pay rent, so that sucks. And sometimes like you try to do your homework, or to read or to listen, and like Milton has been a blast. It's like been my favorite, like book one, really enjoyed it, like lifted my spirit. But like other classes or paper I had to do, it was very, very difficult to think about literature while you like you have other words.
Yeah, right. It's hard to, you have to not forget that that people are impacted by this in different ways, and some people more severely than others. Thankfully, we're all healthy. People are all healthy. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No. I was.
Professor, I just wanted to say there is no class next week, right?
No. I mean, maybe we'll do an optional thing like last week, like last time. All right.
Yes, please.
Okay. For me, I play this adolescent game about who's better, Shakespeare or Milton. You know that game? It's like the adolescent game the English professors play, who's better, Shakespeare or Milton. So one of the good things about Twitter, and it's very, very different from Facebook in this sense, is that you get to just like write things that occur to you, and it's good just to write them down. And then either people notice them or don't notice them. It's not like Facebook where you care what your friends think. You know, there's so many people and it's so fast that it doesn't really make a difference. So I really enjoy it. So I wrote on Twitter that of course Shakespeare is the better writer, but Milton is the better author, right? Which in a way is just a stupid thing to say. I mean, I acknowledge it. But what I'm kind of getting at is that Milton as an author, as a person, he's just very, very, very compelling. And that personality is, and that's the huge distinction between Milton and Shakespeare, is that personality is totally absent from Shakespeare. Totally, right? There's the total absence of personality, where the personality is completely mediated through the drama and through the characters. But with Milton, you just hear him talking to you. You hear his urgency. You know, Milton, in a way, even though he's in this kind of Protestant context, he's angry about some of the same things that I'm angry about. I don't know if you're angry about them also, but, you know, he's angry about religious monopolies. He's angry about bad teachers. He's angry about bad institutions. That's really what's driving Milton through his whole life. He's just really, I think he's primarily pissed off at bad teachers, at teachers who are using their position, whether they're, and mostly he's talking about in theological context, people who are using their position instead of guiding people to misleading them. Yes, Tikva.
Perhaps not to the same extent that Milton does, but Shakespeare does that as well. There's this quote that I keep on thinking about when I hear about the people who are still davening, which is, "'Tis mad idolatry to make the service greater than the God."
That's from Charles and Cressida. That's a good one, yeah. Whatever, yeah, I hear that. But Milton's urgency as a person is so much stronger. And this is a line we've maybe looked at before. I'll just read it, and we'll see it in a second. Satan is saying that he says, "Farewell, happy fields, to heaven where joy forever dwells. Hail, horrors, hail, infernal world, and thou profoundest hell, receive thy new possessor. One," here's the important part, "one who brings a mind not to be changed by place or time. The mind is its own place, and in itself can make a heaven of hell, a hell of heaven." I think we saw a version of that in Christopher Marlowe's Dr. Faustus. And we did a coming attraction, and we said, in the history of interiority, in the history of subjectivity, in the history of individualism, there is a kind of line between Marlowe's Faustus, Hamlet, and then we get this figure of Satan. Of course, and in Satan, Milton is kind of testing the parameters, I think, of the individual, just in the same way that Marlowe is testing the parameters of the individual in Dr. Faustus. Milton's voice is certainly inflected by that satanic energy, right? No matter what you say about Paradise Lost, his voice is energized by the same kind of powers that inform Satan. And critics, as we mentioned, have a hard time understanding that or deciding what to make of it. But I'm just going back to what I was saying earlier, that voice of Milton, it just grabs you. It's so compelling. Meaning in terms of its urgency and its commitment and its sense of what's right. I don't know. Am I oversimplifying Milton here? Am I romanticizing him maybe too much? Yeah, Nathaniel, you're a little bit more cynical.
A little bit.
Yeah. Can you say that without making a face?
Oh, I was making a face at myself for my own cynicism.
Right, remember Wordsworth at the beginning of the 19th century says, and he's facing his own political problems, and he said, Milton, were you alive at this season? We need you now. We need a leader now. We need somebody to lead us. That's how I feel. I feel that voice is a voice that, I don't know, I feel maybe I could be led by. Shuki, go ahead.
I don't know. For me, Shakespeare was writing in the moment for the moment, whereas Milton writes for eternity. He's always aware of like history.
Interesting. I mean, Ben Jonson does say that Shakespeare writes for all time. Remember, that's the, but interesting. Right. I was going to add something extremely insightful to what Natanel was saying, which just skipped my mind. What were we just talking about?
You know, it's amazing, Professor. Just when I read it, it's amazing how much knowledgeable Milton is with about the Old Testament.
Oh yeah, can I say? Sure. Right. So that's one of the things. So did you get to see? Did you get to see the mini lectures offline?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Good.
I didn't have the time to see them, but I read the book.
You'll make confessions to me after class, okay?
Wait, I want to ask. What kind of response did you get on Twitter when you asked which is better?
They're like, what? What?
Did you see an Intelligence Squared episode on this topic? Mm. They had a debate in England.
Okay, right, with Jim Shapiro and who's a Shakespearean.
Yeah, and they had
a whole thing. Yeah, Ronnie, I'll say this for you. Ronnie, you're there. You one if by land, two if by sea. So since Ronnie's a big Led Zeppelin set fan, I said if you don't understand this, then maybe this will help you. There's a parallel. This might only make sense to Ronnie. That Led Zeppelin's best song is Nobody's Fault But Mine. But the greatest rock and roll song of all time, not what you think, is In My Time of Dying. It doesn't really make sense because they're both by Led Zeppelin, and how can you say one? But they're just like, they're different metrics. They're different parameters. Ronnie, does that make sense to you? She's not there. Yeah, thumbs up for Ronnie. Good. Okay. Fine. So follow me on Twitter. Just kidding. I really am just kidding. So are there any questions about the lectures? Any points that we can start with as a way of getting into Paradise Lost today?
I wanted to ask.
Yeah.
Yes. You spoke a bit about the intentional dissociation of Milton the poet and Milton the regicide.
Right.
And I guess I was wondering how much you feel Milton the regicide we see within the poem.
Oh, so that's, I mean, so I think one of the things, we said that the title Paradise Lost is not only reflecting on a religious reality, that is the Old Testament, but it's also reflecting on a political reality, that is the loss of whatever vision of they're practicing for Yom HaTzibut outside my window. That's the noise. That it's also registering political defeat, that Paradise Lost is about political defeat. So the question is, how is that political energy, how is it represented in Paradise Lost? Now, very simplistic readers of Milton will say, well, of course, Satan is the hero of the poem and he represents that revolutionary energy. But if you read the poem carefully, it really, really doesn't make sense. Oh, so what I was going to say before, teaching and Milton's whole poem presupposes an idea of exceptionalism. That is, that there's somebody who is worthy to teach me, that I can actually sit and listen to somebody else teach and speak. And I think that a whole idea of exceptionalism is really under attack today. It's at the root of a lot of anti-Semitism, because Judaism is the origin of exceptionalism in the West. And we claim we're special. And that the exceptionalism has had a rocky history. Of course, as you guys just pointed out, as C pointed out, the English appropriate that exceptionalism. Milton appropriates that exceptionalism. The great Protestant nation surpasses the Hebrew nation. And then Americans in Boston, they will appropriate that as well. They will appropriate that exceptionalism. So it's not British exceptionalism or Hebraic exceptionalism, but American exceptionalism. And I think that idea really is very much under attack. And for that reason, I think people misunderstand Paradise Lost, because I think above all, Milton is a pedagogue. He is a teacher. We may some people may suggest at the end that he's an unsuccessful teacher. I think that involves being a bad reader. But I think Milton is trying to, like other figures in the Renaissance, and we spoke about this, he is trying to create a certain kind of revolution in reading, and or a way of reading. And part of that is believing that there's somebody there, there's a teacher who has something to teach you. And that's part of, for me also, of why I connect to Milton, because I feel him as somebody who I admire and maybe even want to emulate in some strange way, even though our worlds are separated by so many centuries and so many different kinds of assumptions and worldviews, right? Which goes back to what we were saying at the beginning of class, that, and I think, I mean, I've just enjoying living it out, that you can learn from somebody who you disagree with, right? I mean, that's very religious communities say that's not the case. You can only learn from somebody who you agree with about everything. And then there are other kinds of fundamentalist communities, let's say very...
You learn the most from people who are different than you.
Okay, good, okay. So there are different kinds of fundamentalism. Not only religious, but, you know, progressive or other forms of political fundamentalism. Anyway, okay, so good. So I thought for today, and we will have a shorter class, since I've already asked you to listen to an hour and 10 minutes of talk. I wanted to focus on more on Milton's poetry and his representation. And through this passage, really just starting here, this description of Satan, I want to, if we can, if we're successful, maybe broaden out to speak about some of the issues that were important to us. I'll be honest with you that when I teach this to undergraduates, and some of you have studied Milton with me as an undergraduate, we did it very quickly. I never teach this passage, and I'm kind of focusing just for myself on stuff that I haven't read that carefully, where I haven't taught, and therefore not read that carefully, because I really want to take advantage of you and learn from you. So here is. We're now in hell, and Beelzebub and Satan are having this conversation. And let's go for here. So Satan spake, and him Beelzebub thus answered, leader of those bright armies, bright, which but the omnipotent could not have foiled. None could have foiled. If once they hear that voice, their liveliest pledge of hope in fears and dangers heard so oft in worst extremes, and on the perilous edge of battle when it raged in all assaults their surest signal, they will soon resume, he's talking about the other devils who are depressed, they will soon resume new courage and revive, though now they lie groveling and prostrate on yon lake of fire. As we erewhile, astounded and amazed, no wonder fallen such a pernicious height. We in our experience from reading Spencer, we know that being astonished and amazed, is kind of like being robbed of your senses, not being able to judge independently, not being able to read. So here it's an interesting appropriation of that. Milton's God is overwhelming, astounding, amazing Satan as they lie prostrate on this lake of fire. Now here's the representation.
I have a question.
Yeah, Professor. Yeah.
Are they from different narratives? I mean, Beelzebub and Satan, or is Beelzebub some biblical entity here? Or is he some pagan entity?
I don't know. Somebody, please. I mean, doesn't he go on to, let's see, here we go. Lord of the flies or chief of the devils. See, yes. Matthew 10, Mark 3, yes. Luke 11.
It's explicitly Christian.
See Marlowe's Dr. Faustus and Burton's Anatomy of
So Satan is inferior to him or?
No. Satan is he's the main guy. He's the archangel or the archangel.
Beelzebub is like his second in command or something.
Right. So Milton is inherited.
How important is it to know the different types of angels?
Well, there will be a test on this at the end of the semester. I don't know.
I'm saying in terms of this, in terms of Paradise Lost, like, do they talk about the different ranks of angels a lot? Is it important to know that an archangel is above a whatever?
Right. Well, Satan is above everybody else. And like what I said to you about the pagan gods, and maybe we'll get to them a little bit later, it's always helpful and cool to follow Milton's genealogies and to see where he's getting stuff. And not only to see where he's getting stuff, but to see how he takes what he gets and manipulates it and rewrites it. But, you know, there's so much in Milton, you have to kind of decide what you're going to click on. Milton is inheriting a complicated angelology, probably from the New Testament and the Church Fathers, and he's using them for his own purposes.
You asked us on the email, what is our favorite simile?
Yeah.
And if we can refer to the Leviathan one, it's just a great one.
Why do you like that?
Yeah, it's from Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer.
Oh, okay. So I mentioned to you that Milton knew Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer in Latin, so he stole that from there. Why did you like that, C?
I don't know. It's just grandiose. It's a nice representation.
It is, yeah. Okay, so I don't know. We could go back to that, but we did all a whole half hour on this. So let's look at this now. Here's another description of Satan. He scarce had ceased when the superior fiend, there you go, Tikva, when the superior fiend was moving toward the shore, his ponderous shield. What alarm bells go off when you read that, ponderous shield?
Achilles
and Arthur and Aeneas. He scarce had ceased when the superior fiend was moving toward the shore, his ponderous shield, ethereal temper. What does that mean? It's made out of...
Tempered, what
author? Tempered, from Spencer. Tempered in ethereal heavenly fire.
Okay.
Massy, large, and round. Here Milton is having it both ways. How can something be both ethereal and massy, large, and round? Weird, no?
That's the whole point.
What, Shani?
Isn't that the whole point? He's so all-consuming. We're not even supposed to be able to comprehend the way he looks.
Ah, okay.
No, I thought it was tempered by heavenly fire.
Right. Mean, oh, I see. Okay.
It's light.
No part of the forging.
I see. Okay. So good. His ponderous shield, ethereal. Yeah. See what?
No, Professor Kramer always says that when you don't have the means by which to comprehend something, then you can resort to oxymorons.
Mm.
You know, when there is that language doesn't suffice.
Right. I think I was just looking at a book by a colleague, he's a philosopher, and he wrote a book about Milton from a philosophical perspective. And it's very hard to get scholarly books published, take it from me. This book was published on Oxford University Press. It's very hard to get a book published on Oxford University Press. The readers for his book were obviously philosophers, because he may be a good philosopher, but he's a terrible reader of Milton. Why is he a terrible reader of Milton? Because philosophers don't get what C is talking about. They don't get oxymoron. They don't get paradox. Philosophers will reject paradox as contradiction. And so and I think going back to what C was saying in the name of Professor Kramer, that sometimes language is most effective when it admits on some level that it's failing. And that's why poetic language, I said this in the video, that's why poetic language is superior, because it realizes its insufficiency. It realizes it can't do everything. And because of the humility built into it, it can do more than those people who say, well, I can give it all to you. Poetry will never provide a unified theory of all things. It never will. From a poetic perspective, that will always, always be impossible. That was my envious talk about my colleague who got a book published in Oxford University Press. But there is a kind of disciplinary divide. I have another colleague, and he wrote a good book on Milton. He's a literary scholar. He wrote a book called Milton Among the Philosophers. And whenever I think of that book, and I know him very well, he's a very brilliant scholar, I always think that it really shouldn't be called Milton Among the Philosophers, it should be called Milton Against the Philosophers. I mean, this guy, Stephen Fallon, is trying to argue that Milton is situated, he's writing in relationship to Hobbes, he's writing in relationship to Descartes, in book 11 and 12 especially. But going back to what C was saying, from my point of view, he's refusing their categories because philosophers can't deal with paradox. It becomes contradiction, like the Aristotelian idea of non-contradiction. Poets don't have to deal with that. Yes, but going back to this description, and whoever said the first thing, Shani, that it's beyond our comprehension. There's something, and I think I mentioned to you that Joseph Addison starts to use the word sublime in relationship to Milton. And sublimity, as we've discussed it for many authors, means really what transcends language, what goes beyond language, what can't be described. So Milton simultaneously gestures in the direction of whatever I'm describing for you, to you can't be described. But then what does he do? He goes on and describes it. His ponderous shield, ethereal temper, massy, large, and round behind him cast. The broad circumference hung on his shoulders like the moon, whose orb, through optic glass, the Tuscan artist views at evening from the top of Fesoli or in Valderno to descry new lands, rivers or mountains in her spotty globe. What? First of all, what is this optic glass and who is this Tuscan artist?
Galileo.
Special guest star in Paradise Lost, Galileo. He shows up many, many times. And he's got this optic glass. What's the optic glass?
Telescope.
His telescope. Milton, the story goes, met Galileo when he went to Italy in 1638. And Galileo is a continued presence in Paradise Lost. He shows up more than once. And I think he's always accompanied by this optic glass.
Can I ask a question about that?
Yeah.
Galileo was blind by that time, no?
Okay.
So I'm just interested, is there like a particular reason that Milton then chooses to put him still looking through the glass or just...
Okay, maybe. Let's add on once we figure out what's going on.
Well,
maybe,
wasn't Milton blind? So it's about being able to see while still being blind. He wrote this entire book when he was blind.
Okay. I mean, at the beginning of book three, we will see Milton referring explicitly to his blindness. And maybe that's at play here, but let's just try to unpack this set of metaphors in like their simple meaning here. So Satan here is Milton is representing Satan here. I mean, I just like this almost casual gesture. His ponderous shield, ethereal temper, massy, large, and round behind him cast. I just think that detail puts him in line or makes us think of him in the same category as Achilles or Aeneas, or I'm even thinking like James Dean from the 1950s. I'm not that old, but you know who James Dean is? Yeah. The broad circumference hung on his shoulders like the moon. Okay, so Satan is like the moon. Okay, what does the rest of this do? Why does Milton add the rest of this here? Whose orb through optic glass the Tuscan artist views at evening from the top of Fesoli or in Valderno to descry new lands?
Isn't he saying that like when we look at the moon, we're actually looking at some celestial beings? There's like a whole play going on above us.
I think if we think back to the terms that Dr. Feldman taught us from I.E. Richards of tenor and vehicle, the vehicle is cosmological, meaning it's this Tuscan artist Galileo seeing the moon. The tenor is that spiritual realm, Shuki, meaning that of Satan. So my question is, why does Milton introduce in this metaphor not only the moon? Why isn't he just satisfied with the moon? The Borat circumference hung on his shoulders like the moon, like the moon. Why don't we just edit out the next six lines? What does he gain there?
Maybe it connects the celestial to the earth, to the mundane.
Okay, good. I mean, and I think that that's the metaphor itself is doing that, right? And that goes back to good. What we were exploring, what I was exploring what in the video. And I'll just say it again, because it struck me. I have a colleague who teaches teachers, and she emphasizes in her teaching the importance for students to always write down their conclusions at the end of a class. And I think it's really important for people to do that, even for lecturers, to get to say things. And that's one of the reasons I'm really grateful for our classes. I get to say things that otherwise I would have only thought. And when you say them, it's a lot clearer. So we'll come back to this at the end, but I think there is a sense, as Donna is suggesting, that there will always be a disjoint between the physical and the spiritual. But in a way, this is the only way Milton has of getting at it, that is through metaphor. We'll go back to that in a bit. But why not cut out those five or six lines, whose orb to spotty globe? Building on what Donna said. I mean, Milton gives us this image of the moon with the Tuscan artist, and with the telescope, he's adding the person who sees the moon, right? Why does he add that? Let's all take a deep breath while we think about the answer. Everybody heard the question that I asked? Let me just rephrase it one more time.
Can we repeat the whole concept here? I'm not following, I'm sorry.
I'm just asking, why is it that Milton asks, whose orb through optic glass the Tuscan artist views at evening from the top of Thessaly, blah, blah, blah. Why does he add that in? I mean, what does he gain? And I've added a little bit more here. What does he gain here by adding that act of perception?
Does he want to humanize it? In a way.
What did Donna say?
Donna, what did you say?
That he connects the celestial with the earth, the spiritual and the physical.
Right. He's finding a way, and Milton, of all people, is extremely skeptical of this, because we know that Protestants, both from Professor Kramer and me, we know that Protestants and Puritans are extremely suspicious of the idea of embodying the spiritual. And yet Milton, with metaphor, is doing just that. Milton is offering us these images. So I'm asking again, why does Milton include Galileo here?
Well, it's a way of building on what Donna said about the spiritual and the earthly, I suppose. It's a way of connecting the scientific and the theological. Mm-hmm. Saying that the sign, it could be a way of saying, one could say that Milton is saying that the scientific is another way of viewing God.
Okay.
Or viewing the divine. It's not.
It's a little bit drushy.
I think that he might be gesturing that the only way we can perceive the divine is through the telescope. Like.
Good. Now we're talking a little bit, but Dafka the telescope. Only the telescope?
Because our naked eye is incomprehensible to us.
Right, the truth will make everyone blind. It's like that Emily Dickinson poem.
I use this metaphor a lot. Thank you, Tikva, for that reference. I use this reference a lot in my teaching. I wonder if I get it from Galileo, that metaphor, or from Milton, that metaphors are their lenses on the world. And in a way, Milton is using the metaphor of the optic glass as the as a way of understanding that the only way we understand or see anything is through this process of, see, for me, the optic glass is not, it's not just the optic glass, it's the person who holds it. That there's always, that the spiritual will always be mediated. It's always seen by someone, and not only by someone here, Galileo, through optic glass, the Tuscan artist views it evening from the top of Thessaly or in Valderno, by someone in some place. And here for Milton, I mentioned to you that or is one of his favorite words. It's someone in either this place or this place. Why is Milton being cute here? Let's build on what C is saying, that this is really about interpretation. And in order to see these spiritual realms, you need a special lens. And Milton is going to give us lens after lens after lens through which to see the divine. And that lens here is literally a lens, but the lenses that Milton always gives us are these metaphors. So why is Milton being our travel agent here? Why are we seeing all of Italy?
Does it have anything to do with the fact that Galileo was persecuted by the church, that he was that he was revealing truths that were uncomfortable for the Catholic Church?
I'm sure Milton identifies with Galileo. I never thought of that in that sense. That he's a rebel. But now I'm just asking about the two places. Valderno, what's the other one, or Fesoli?
Wait, the two places being the abyss that Satan is in, and Italy?
I was saying that it's not only that it's seen by someone, but it's seen one by someone in some place, but it's not one place. From the top of Fesoli or in Valderno, why does he mention two different places?
15 perspectives.
Because, and I think here Milton is suggesting that, and here is Milton's, I think, iconoclasm. How can you be an iconoclast if you're a poet? Doesn't make sense, right? So I think Milton's iconoclasm lies in placing one image against another. And Milton is suggesting here there's always another perspective. It's either here or here. Galileo is here or here, and his perspective on what he will see is dependent upon where he is. What does that say about Satan? Do I know who Satan is in the end?
No. Draw me partially.
Draw me a picture of Satan.
I don't think you're supposed to know who Satan is. If you can comprehend him, how scary could he be?
But there's also a thing with Satan shifts other people's perceptions. Mm. As opposed to you seeing from different perspectives, your perceptions are pushed by someone else.
One more time, Natsuno.
One of the things that Satan does in the he moves other people's perceptions.
Okay, right.
Rather than them finding their own lenses.
Well, right. I mean, fine. I mean, here it's Milton representing Satan. Satan also is figured, just like Archimago. Remember him in A Fairy Queen? Just like Archimago, Satan is associated with artifice and art. That Milton, at the same time that he represents himself, obviously as a teacher, and he's teaching through images, there are other figures in the poem, primarily Satan, who is also manipulating images, and manipulating images not to lead towards whatever, spiritual enlightenment, but to lead in the wrong way, on the wrong path.
I remember learning with you the fact that that's the whole point, the reason that he's writing like this, because he said, how can a poet be an iconoclast? Mm. His way of teaching is showing you that through seeing like the picture, that's the way that you'll be able to break it down and see clearly.
Now you see it. Remember, there's another image. Some of you will remember this. Almost all of you will remember this from our undergraduate discussion. There's a number.
The ambassadors?
No. That image of when Satan once again is being seen, not like the moon, but like a sunspot, and It's through a glazed optic tube, again, Galileo. And the last phrase of the image is, yet never saw. Remember that? That you, Milton says, look, 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 look. But by the end of it is, if you thought you saw it, you didn't see it, yet never saw. Meaning it's an image that comes into being and then almost self-destructs. My teacher of Milton, Stanley Fish, who's one of the people I studied with, he wrote a book called Self-Consuming Artifacts. It's untight.
Sorry.
Some serious academic gibberish.
Please, Tikva, there's some serious academics here. Actually, Fish has a sense of humor. Self-consuming artifacts. Here's, I think, an exhibit from, oopsie, from, here is, I think, an exhibit from a museum in which the this is like a very 60s or 70s thing. You go to the museum, there's this thing there, and it self-destructs in front of you. So the artwork, the signifying artwork self-destructs in front of you. So that's a little bit on the postmodernish cheesy side. But it's useful to use that metaphor in relationship to Milton, that Milton is providing this image, this artifact, which kind of self-consumes, self-destructs in front of your eyes. Meaning, remember from Areopagitica, which we're not reading together, Milton says, he who thinks we are to pitch our tent here, that person shows himself to be very far from the truth. Remember that? Remember that metaphor of camping? He who thinks we are to pitch our tent here, that we've reached our end, that person shows by claiming we've got there that he is very far from truth. So if you put everything in one metaphor, in one perspective, then from Milton's perspective, you're an idolater. Yes, Nathaniel, you're raising your hand so dutifully. You're raising your hand, Nathaniel?
That was like half an hour ago. It's okay.
I see.
Does that make Milton's poem like that picture that says this is a pipe, or you know, this famous painting?
Yeah, this is not a pipe, this is a pipe.
Yeah, something, it poses this whole issue, or
yeah, but it's a more, this is not a pipe, it is a pipe.
Professor, can you repeat the pitch our tents?
Oh, you know that one. See, I don't have to repeat that. Come on, remember, Milton says it's hard to believe that a person who believes in a religious person believes such a thing. He says, he who says we are to pitch our tent here, by which he means, he who says that I've already arrived, I've got here, right? People who claim perfection in this world, I got here. Person who says that person is very far from the truth. Another way of putting it is the way one of my favorite philosophers, this guy named Hilary Putnam said. Putnam writes, enough may not be everything, but enough is enough. Enough may not be everything, but enough is enough. Those are really words to live
by. I like that.
Yes? Estelle?
What is that supposed to mean?
Enough may
not be. No, I just said I like that. Like it's nice.
Why do you like it? Why do you like it, Estelle?
Because having enough is all about perspective. So if you think that this is enough for you, it might not be everything, but it's enough because that's all you need.
See, why did you like it?
I like it because it reminded me of Shakespeare last year, that the fact that poetry concedes its deficiencies. You know, I'm having a hard time articulating. You remember what you told us?
I don't remember what I said, but what you said sounds very nice. Meaning you can't, Milton is not a messianist. Milton doesn't believe that we can have the perfection of whatever the afterworld represents now. People who believe that for Milton are idolaters. You can never have everything. If you claim to have everything, you're not seeing properly. Enough may not be everything. It's really an injunction. Enough may not be everything, but enough is enough. Meaning once you strive for perfection, think of theological parties in this country who want to bring theological agendas into the political realm, right? They're basically saying, I think, And these are not so much the Haredim, but other people on the Israeli continuum. They're acting as if Messiah has already come. Messiah has not come. We're living in a world of imperfection. And in a world of imperfection, you can't have everything. And people who claim to have everything and want to impose it upon the rest of us, they're autocrats. They're fundamentalists. And Milton, as urgent as religion is for him, is strangely not a fundamentalist, certainly not in that sense. So let's continue here. Yeah, Tikva, did you have a comment?
Wait, who did you say said that sentence?
Hillary Putnam. There he is, see? Okay. Here, we're just gonna continue, but we'll break right at line 330. His spear, to equal with the tallest pine hewn on Norwegian hills to be the mast of some great amiral, were but a wand he walked with to support uneasy steps over the burning marl, not like those steps on heaven's azure and the torrid climb smote on him sore besides, vaulted with fire. Natheless, he so endured, till on the beach of that inflamed sea he stood and called his legion's angel forms who lay entranced, thick as autumnal leaves that strode the brooks in Vallombrosa, where the Etrurian shades, high overarched, embower, or scattered sedge afloat when with fierce winds Orion armed hath vexed the Red Sea coast, whose waves o'erthrow Busiris and his Memphian chivalry, while with perfidious hatred they pursued the sojourners of Goshen, who beheld from safe shore their floating carcasses and broken chariot wheels, so thick, bestrown, abject, and lost lay these covering the flood under amazement of their hideous change. That was very hard for me to even read. I gather it was hard to understand as well. Let's use our I.A. Richards tool chest again. So tenor and vehicle.
The vehicle is the Egyptians, and the tenor are the angels.
Right, the sojourners of Goshen being Egypt.
You skipped ahead a little bit, because first we have these. What is he describing here? I mean, what is he trying to let us have access to? What is Milton trying to let us see?
The legions of Satan.
Oh, good. Okay, good. So the legions of Satan, right?
And the scene after the fall, where they—it's the scene after the fall, after they fought.
The fallen angels, not the fall of that. Oh, okay,
now right. The fall of the angels after they fought and lost, and they're scattered on this lava sea. Mm.
Right. So first, there's an or here as well. First, there before we get to the Goshen metaphor, which is very complicated. What's the first one? Who lay entranced, thick as autumn leaves that strow the brooks in Vallombrosa, where the Etrurian shades high overarched embower. It's a very beautiful image, right? Here are these legions seen as these autumn leaves under these Etrurian, I guess, Italian shades. I guess it's probably all Virgilian. So we're seeing we're seeing these legions through the metaphor of these strewn leaves. We'll get back to that, why Milton is using that metaphor. Shall we read the next part again? Or scattered sedge. What's sedge?
Type of soil, according to the Schmincke. Oh, no, I was wrong.
Sedge, oh my goodness. In Hebrew, what second? What is that over here? Oh, Yam Suf, seaweed as in the Red Sea. In Hebrew, Yam Suf. So reeds, I guess. Or scattered sedge afloat when with fierce winds Orion, he's the god of wind, I guess, armed, hath vexed the Red Sea coast, whose waves o'erthrew Busiris, I think that's Pharaoh, and his Memphian chivalry, that's the Egyptian army, while with perfidious hatred they pursued the sojourners of Goshen, who beheld from the safe shore their floating carcasses of broken chariot wheels, so thick bestrown abject and lost lay these, covering the flood under the amazement of their hideous change. Wow, it's really complicated, right? Let's leave those leaves aside. This is definitely, let's just take it step by step. So they're, first, what are they like? Scattered sedge.
You know, it's funny how he makes a transition from the leaves through the suf to onto the Yam Suf. You know what I'm saying? And also it's nice how we harness Orion, like the Greek god, in the service of Jehovah, of the Israelite god.
Right. I mean, that's so Miltonic, right? This idea that you use whatever is at hand in order to get what you want to get at. But interesting. See, there's probably more. I think we can explore that even further. But I like what you said. Also, it reminds me of, remember in the middle of the canonization, there's where tapers to and she and I. Remember the guy on the outside called them flies or a moth, and he says then where tapers to, where candles and. Somebody remember that line? I'm sorry, now that I mentioned it.
Is this the fleas one or the other?
No,
the canonization.
I'm just thinking of the associations that Donne makes in those poems. You see his imagination at work. Call us what you will, we are made such by love. Call her one, me another, fly, where tapers to and our own cost die, and we and us find the eagle and the dove. The phoenix hath more wit. Here Donne is kind of going crazy, right? I mean, he goes from being called a fly to these moths being attracted to tapers or candles, eagles and then doves. And I think also it just reminds me here, as C is saying, there's a kind of aesthetic continuity between the leaves and these reeds strewn over the Red Sea. Good. Thank you, C. Whose waves o'erthrow Busiris and his Memphian chivalry, while with perfidious hatred they pursued the sojourners of Goshen, who beheld from safe shore their floating carcasses and broken chariot wheels, so thick bestrown abject, and lost lay these, covering the flood, under amazement of their hideous change. I just keep on getting confused in this part of the metaphor.
The last line that gets me, I understand it up until the last line.
Well, maybe you can help us up until the, I'm not even up to the last line.
Okay.
At what stage are we? I want to ask a question first, okay? What is the time frame of this? When are we seeing whatever we're seeing? While with perfidious hatred they pursued, that sounds like a ongoing action, even though it's in the past. While with perfidious hatred they pursued the sojourners of Goshen. So I'm imagining them in the Sea of Reeds. But then after the comma, who beheld from safe shore their floating carcasses and broken chariot wheels. Which is it? Are they in the midst of being pursued? Or are they standing at the other side of the sea and looking down triumphantly at the Egyptians? Whose kids are misbehaving? Whose kids are those?
Oh, that's the neighbors playing outside, sorry.
Tommy, you may have to tell them, you may have to put your head out the window, right? No, don't be a bad neighbor. Let the kids enjoy. Is my question a reasonable question? Am I reading this properly? I was just so confused when I read it the first time, and this is why I wanted to focus on it with you.
Well, what he's he's kind of inserting, as it were, some kind of like parenthetical details. So like scattered sedge afloat. And then he's saying, well, what scattered sedge? And then he goes into this whole detail. But what is going on with the sedge? It's so thick, bestewn and abject, lost there. It's everywhere. It's covering the flood.
Okay.
And the whole bit about the Egyptians chasing the Israelites is kind of in parentheses. It's added detail. It's just that instead of using semicolons, he uses commas, and we get very confused.
The semicolon can be your friend. Are we being Zoom bombed by Russians? No. Punctuation can be your friend, right? Be nice to it. I don't know semicolon or comma here, but why the parentheses? What Tikva is calling this parentheses? I'm asking. I'm confused by the temporal frame here. Where are we seeing these Egyptians? Where are we? Are we being pursued, or are we looking back at them and seeing them already defeated?
We're seeing them already defeated.
So why then the detail, as you call it, of?
Because it's fresh in their minds. Also, the Satan and his people are being pursued. They were kicked out of heaven.
Well, no. So here's the poet is talking here, right? While with perfidious hatred they pursued the sojourners of Goshen, who beheld from the safe shore their floating carcass. It doesn't make sense. Where are you? Where are we? Are we in the midst or are we at the end? And why does Milton complicate it by giving us both perspectives, both in the midst while we're being pursued and at the end while we're triumphant? Renat, you're very quiet today. Is that especially annoying to be called on?
Sorry, I'm just a little bit out of it today.
Okay, that's fine. I was making contact.
But that's anybody, how we experience tumultuous events.
And we
experience them afterwards. There's too much.
Okay, no, but any good. I mean, I am with you.
Is it perhaps the two perspectives that we talked about earlier, that there's always more than one perspective?
Well, right.
And that is kind of in sequence, though, you know, he kind of like telescopes it together, but it's in sequence. First they're pursued, then they stand on the shore and look and see all the chariots broken. Mm.
I mean, I think it is worth pointing out, following in what Alana is saying, that we had those two places of Fezzuli or Valderno, and Milton does give us two metaphors, one of the leaves and then one of the Red Sea. Alana, of course, was referring to the two perspectives in that second metaphor. They're different temporal perspectives though, and I think that's important. Again, where are we? Are we in the midst? Or are we at the end?
Both. I think because, remember, there's you talked about the different perception of time. Mm-hmm. So he's showcasing, I think, both at once.
Okay. I mean, it like in the nativity, in a poem like the Nativity Ode, which is so clearly about different conceptions of time, you see what Milton is doing clearly with these moments of what Frank Hermode calls kairos, the fullness of time at the beginning in the creation, at Sinai, at the end of days. But here, even in this very local passage, in this very small simile or metaphor, we have both conceptions of time compressed. That is, so we're simultaneously living in time with the Israelites and being pursued, what Tikva says, feeling the urgency, the trauma of that experience. But we are also at the same time on the other end of the shore looking back triumphant.
But it's also, to me, it's kind of a shift of perspective, because in the Bible, it's like at least in the Jewish perspective, it's a triumphant moment of God saving and doing the right thing, whereas he's looking at it in horror at the carcasses floating.
All right, so let's just, he's looking at it. Let's me just read the end so we can understand what Shuki just said. While with perfidious hatred, they pursued the sojourners of Gershon, who beheld from safe shore their floating carcasses and broken chariot wheels. So thick, bestrown, abject, and lost lay these, covering the flood under amazement of their hideous change. Uh-huh. Now, so we're looking at them through the lens of the sojourners who have arrived on the other side of the Red Sea, and they themselves are looking at themselves, abject and lost lay these, covering the flood under amazement of their hideous chain. What were you saying, Shuki, just going back to what you said?
I just thought he's also reflecting on the horror of the event that happened for the Egyptians. He's also looking at for the Egyptians.
Right, right. So I think, and just to maybe circle back to something that we've said before, that in Milton, we're given these two perspectives, which are particular. One is the perspective of not knowing what's going to happen. We're being pursued. The reality of evil. Milton writes a good theodicy. A bad theodicy is one in which the author takes the divine perspective. The divine perspective is not available to the human. When an author takes the divine perspective, he's almost saying that what he has to say is of no relevance to the human, because we live in time, we live in imperfection. And Milton here is accommodating that even in this metaphor, the sense of the reality of evil. Sure, we make it to the other side of the Red Sea, but we still live in that realm of history. Okay, I'm running a little out of steam. Should we take, you want to take a 20 minute break and then we'll come back for another half hour? Is that okay? Good?
Yeah. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, people can go have coffee and I'm happy to listen to questions also. Yeah.
Wait, just clarifying what you just said, you said Milton gives us two different perspectives. What were those two different perspectives? The reality of evil, that's one perspective or both perspectives?
Is he still here? Oh yeah, see, what did I say? I'm just kidding.
You said, I mean, I just took the notes. We get a perspective of reality of evil. When an author takes the divine perspective, which is not ours, then the odyssey fails. I don't know if that's what I got.
You can, like, write my memoir for me, see? You're, like, taking very...
I mean, I try. It's not...
What I'm trying to say, Devorah, and maybe I'm not being clear, is that a theodicy that only deals with divine time, with the happy ending, right? Oh, it's all good. There's going to be a happy ending. You know, in the Talmud, there are two brachot that people say. One, if something good happens, you say atov ha-meitiv, right? If something very bad happens, you say lo aleinu dayen amet, right? Mm-hmm. Right. So I remember having a teacher once who spoke with great urgency about and with great conviction that if anybody comes up to you and says after your field has been flooded, whatever that may mean in somebody's life at a certain time, and says Dayan Emet, really, why? Because everything in the end is going to work out, you should punch them in the nose. And this was this very Adin, a very nice guy, right?
Who's punching who?
No punching people. It's if somebody comes up to you and says, when your field is flooded, don't worry, it'll all be for the good in the end. I mean, right? You're allowed, what I'm trying to say, in Jewish law, you are allowed to experience loss. You are allowed to express that. I mean, you know, gamzu l'tova, I get that part also, right? But there is the sense, at least from a legal perspective, that if something bad happens, you are allowed to feel it. You don't say, oh, it'll all be, everything is gonna be great in the end when your basement is flooded. So I think Milton accommodates that perspective. The bad—
other people will say it to you.
Right. So when, I think you're allowed to say it for yourself, this is my the world according to me. You're allowed to say it for yourself. When other people say it for you, what they're doing is they're narrating your life for you, and that's bad. You get to say back to them, thank you very much. I get to narrate my own life, right? And if I decide to narrate my life in a certain way, which it's Gamzu L'tuva, L'tova, I think that's what, in a way, without getting too distracted, that's what tshuva is about. That's what Jewish repentance is about, is re-narration, rewriting. But when somebody else tells that to you, they're saying to you, I'm narrating the story for you. That's what's so terrible. Today, if you hear like very bad theologians in Israel who are trying to explain Corona, they're telling the story for us. Aside from it being a stupid story, right, which it is, whatever the story they're telling, they're saying, this is the story, and it's authoritative not only for me, it's authoritative for you. So Milton, in that metaphor, he's accommodating the being pursued. Yeah, we get to the end. Yeah, we look back and say, wow, thank God. But the perspective, the two perspectives that he shares are the perspective of our temporal world of limitation, of suffering, and also that world of triumph. You know, we wondered when we were reading Homer and Aeschylus and Sophocles, why are the Greeks so depressive, right? Odysseus is a man of suffering. Oedipus is the guy with the swollen foot. Aeschylus starts out with, oh, to be an end to all of our pain. But the Greeks are accommodating that sense of loss, suffering, the human condition. The Christian move, Milton's move, is to accommodate that and say, yeah, but there's an end as well. I'm not counting this in the 20 minutes. So we'll get back together at 5:45. Okay? Excellent. Good. I will put on some music for your pleasure and mine, if you want.
Thank you.
Oh, I have a great thing for you now. Compose conductor.
You know, Professor, there is a piece by Genesis, you know, the band Genesis?
I hate Genesis.
Oh.
I like Peter Gabriel. I don't, Phil Collins just annoys me.
They have a piece, it's called Firth of Fifth. And the intro, the organ intro is just, it's so, the time signature is so, it's just so
What's the song? What is the song?
It's called Firth of Fifth.
Uh-huh. Oh, we're going to listen. We're going to listen to Stravinsky instead, which is a 25-minute piece. This is awesome. This is just incredible. Watch this conductor also. Look how it just, oh, what am I doing here? Why is there no sound? Do you hear anything? Oh, yeah. I like the conductor because he comes out he's coming away.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. And we're back. Dana, can you hear us now?
Yeah, I hear you. I had a problem.
I saw you were frozen. Yeah. Oh, Zahavit, who is the guest audience?
This is my little sister Yara. She wanted to play a game on my phone. So.
How old is she?
She is 3, and everything she says happens. So, she's playing a game on my phone.
Okay.
Yara, you want to say hi? Look, Yara, you want to say hi? You can go back.
Hi, Yara. I'm actually going to have a Zoom. Starting next week.
Yara, you want to go to Zoom gone? I don't think she can concentrate for that long.
It's a great concept. okay. So. During the break, I was thinking that perhaps maybe we had missed the forest from the trees. Do people have any more general questions about like the first book? I mean, I know we did a very close microanalysis of just a few lines. How about just a broader framework on what we're reading and what we're doing and where we are and how the poem starts?
I actually had an observation when I was reading it about the progression of the gods. I'm trying to find it. I wrote it down.
Right.
But I wrote how there was the story of Adonis, right? And I don't know where it is. It was actually very similar to a story in Assyrian mythology.
Okay.
And he, in Milton's, I felt like he was using that to emphasize how similar they are and therefore how close they are. I can't find where I wrote like exactly what story, but I noticed that. And also the vanity of it, because Adonis's whole thing was that he was so obsessed with himself, he couldn't see the world around him. So
that's cool. Oh, yeah. Adonis.
It's line 450 where he mentions Adonis, if that helps.
Right. I know. But I noticed that how similar the stories are, and that and maybe he was using that to show how they're all false, because they're just copying off each other in a way.
So that this is in the genealogy of Tammuz, which is kind of interesting, right, Zavid? Right, which is
Demusi, the crying god, right?
Which is a Hebrew month, and I think in Yechezkel and Ezekiel. There's a reference to the worship of, I guess Thomas was this figure who he's like a phoenix-like figure. He dies and comes back to life.
Yeah, the story was he sort of wept himself to death, and it was his tears that brought the season of winter and rain that nourished the world.
While we're here, let's just read the whole thing. Tammuz came next behind, whose annual wound in Lebanon allured the Syrian damsels to lament his fate in amorous ditties all a summer day. While smooth Adonis from his native rock ran purple to the sea. What's Adonis here? The Lebanese river, the Lebanese river Adonis, red with mud in the summer. Oh. While smooth Adonis from his native rock ran purple to the sea, supposed with blood of Tama's yearly wounded, supposed. That's what you were saying, Zavi, the falseness of it. The love tale infected Sion's daughters. So you see, there's some kinds of poetry that's good, and there's some kind of poetry that's bad. The love tale infected Sion's daughters with like heat, whose wanted passions in the sacred porch Ezekiel saw, when by the vision led his eyes surveyed the dark idolatries of alienated Judah. So this form of idol worship, it's interesting, it's the form of idol worship that begins in Lebanon, but Ezekiel also, whose wanted passions in the sacred porch Ezekiel saw, when by the vision led his eyes surveyed the dark idolatries of alienated Judah.
It's a reference to Ezekiel 28.
Okay.
To the empire. He had a similar infatuation with himself.
Okay. Right.
What were you going to say about the idol worship that starts in Assyria?
I don't know. I was continuing with what Zahavit was saying. Let's read it one more time. Tammuz came next behind. So there's a series. This is one of the pagan entities, I guess, that Milton says from the outset they existed earlier, but they get named later, and he says they get named later in Palestine. Tammuz.
First Tammuzi, and then Tammuz in the land of Israel. And it had such a broad effect on the culture that there is still a Hebrew month named Tammuz.
Wow. Right.
I was also thinking that with the perceptions of time.
Yeah.
One second. And the and how Satan is sort of playing out a story that's already written in a way, because he can't ever win against God. I felt there was also a little bit of the Iliad in there, how they were all playing out a story already written by the gods, and they had no choice but to be players in it.
So that's very interesting, right? So Zahavit is saying, in some sense, that all the world's a stage, and Satan is a player in a play that he will not recognize that he's not the stage director. He thinks that he's the stage director. He thinks that he's the author, and in some ways, and some of us have talked about this before, Satan is one of the first novelists or memoir writers. He's writing his own story. I think novelist is better. And if one thinks of Paradise Lost as entailing a story with this providential frame, what I mean by providential frame is beginning, Bereshit Bara, middle, and end, till one greater man restore us. There's that providential frame, and Satan is like a character in a drama who's trying to break out of it. He doesn't want to be in this play. He wants to be in a play of his own writing. And in some sense, through Satan, Milton is representing this kind of individual who we see in full blossom in America, the self-made man. I write my own story. I tell my own story. That's what Satan is really, what really is aspiring to here. So I think, Zabi, thank you for that genealogy. And it's interesting to see how careful Milton is in building in providing the genealogies and stories of each one of these gods, which we're not going to dwell on at the moment, but let us think about this whole idea of satanic agency, or lack thereof, or what his role is in Paradise Lost. I mean, that's the big debate, as I said to you in the last lecture. The big debate between Miltonists is Milton of the devil's party without knowing it? Or is he writing a poem that Orthodox Christians can safely read to their children on Sunday mornings after church? Now, the problem, of course, is that Satan is the most appealing character on some level. And if he's not the most appealing character, he's got the best lines. He has the best poetry. So romantic started to say, of course, he's the hero of the poem. He's the hero of the poem. Now,
the villains always have the best ones, though.
Okay. I mean, the villains, so Blake says, Milton was of the devil's party.
And didn't know it.
Without knowing it. I just want to read the whole quote.
Yeah, I mean,
we see only the orchestra.
We see only what, Dana?
We see the orchestra still.
Yeah.
Oh, we see the orchestra, right.
Which is nice.
But we cannot see your screen yet.
We don't see your screen.
You do not see my screen.
No. We see the orchestra.
That's what, yeah. Exactly.
You have to somehow change it.
Oh, how do I do that? Oh, so let's go out of that. Are we better now?
No.
Oh, no.
Stop. Yeah.
Stop sharing.
You share screen again?
Okay, stop sharing. Okay, now share screen. Okay, now we should be. Yes. Now we see my screen. And did anybody, can anybody Google the blank, Milton was at the devil's party with that noggin? I just want to see the whole quote.
Now we see it, your screen.
Yeah, I'm just going to see, I'm going to see Blake. Blah, 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 blah.
The quote is on Wikipedia.
Okay. Oh, here it is. Quote by William Blake. Hello. Oh, there it is. The reason Milton wrote in fetters when he wrote of angels and God and at liberty when of devils and hell is because he was a true poet and of the devil's party without knowing it. Do you agree with Blake?
The bit that gets me about this quote is that he's implying that true poets must be of the devil's party. And ooh, I want to know what that says about William Blake's perception of himself as a poet.
Oh my God.
It only makes sense in context of Blake's complete rethinking of all those concepts in Marriage of Heaven and Hell. It's not that helpful just by itself, in my opinion.
Okay.
Read it in context, and it still didn't make sense.
I think poets are of the devil's party.
I was thinking at the end of the earlier session that whole image of the Israelites standing and looking at the army was actually an image of Satan standing on the shore and looking at his disseminated army. And it kind of puts him in the place of the good guys. It puts him, because they were victorious, the children of Goshen, but he wasn't, he actually lost. Mm-hmm. But this is like putting him in the place of the good guys.
I don't know. I mean, for me, Satan is a character who's like very much in denial. I think he has a kind of Oedipal relationship to God. He won't really recognize that God is his father. And he feels really pissed off because in his heart of hearts, he knows that he's a created being. I mean, I think the psyche of Satan, as Milton represents it, is one that's really in conflict and simultaneously is asserting explicitly this independence, but also knows that he's created, which represents problems for him. But there are other ways, and we'll look at them, in which we identify with Satan. Let's just look at the Milton quote more here, Devil's Party. Milton, sorry. Oh, that's the whole thing, okay. Yeah, as Ben was saying, but in Milton, the Father is destiny, the Son, a ratio of the five sentences, whatever that means, and the Holy Ghost, vacuum. I don't know what that's about. Note the reason Milton wrote in fetters when he wrote of angels and God and at liberty when at devils at hell is because he was a true poet of the devil's party without knowing it. So first of all, are true poets of the devil's party without knowing it? Creative writers, Donna?
I think so, yeah. We can relate to these sides of the story. And I think Satan could have been Jesus in the same story, if it ends differently, if he chosen differently, maybe.
That's interesting. Okay. I mean, he'd have to go under a transformation, but Milton does suggest, he does suggest parallels between them. But the way Milton represents it is Satan as a bad copy of Jesus.
Yeah, of course.
Satan, and here's the big difference. You can understand.
But he has a potential. Sorry for
One way of understanding Milton's theology and representation in the same way is that Satan wants the glory. He wants, let's see how I can put this. He wants glory to come to him. Jesus imagines his being as reflecting divine glory. So Jesus is the mediator. It's like Jesus is the perfect metaphor because he acknowledges his similarity and difference with the divine. Satan is all similarity, right?
I thought just, Jesus was the divine.
It's just me. So in Milton, interestingly, for people like me, in Milton, interestingly, Jesus is a created being. So you could ask the question, who cares about the niceties of Christian theology? But the fact that Jesus is not co-eternal with God makes him created and not identical to God, which makes him the perfect metaphor. He is a representative of the divine. Satan's glory is only for himself. He doesn't want to reflect glory to God. He wants all the glory for himself. In a way, Satan, as appealing as Satan is, and we'll see other ways as well, Satan is a narcissist. He's the ultimate narcissist. He does, however, get the best poetry. Yes, Tikva.
Well, I think building on what Zahavit was saying about the Iliad, I think that in some ways, Paradise Lost could be seen to be structured very similarly to the Iliad. You know, in the Iliad, you've got that whole chapter listing all the soldiers, and here you've got this listing of all the soldiers. And whereas in the Iliad, it's doing that to kind of show the cost of war and how all these people are people, here it's kind of showing how... Flip, I had a point, and it was really...
You've made a point already.
No, the bit with the gods and what they represent was really good, and it's just totally gone.
Okay, I mean, do we want to go with that? What do these pagan gods represent in Paradise Lost? Let's stay with the question we were asking, because that is kind of the broader overview that through which we look at the poem. Why does Milton represent Satan in the way that he does?
I wanted to kind of add another question in there, because something stuck out to me whilst reading that I think comes into this. On line 55, when first we meet Satan, we have the thought of lost happiness. And I was thinking, because you mentioned that the paradise lost isn't just the religious paradise that's lost in the explicitly, but also the political paradise that's lost. But also Satan loses his paradise. He loses his place in heaven. Good. And I wondered how much that feeds into kind of Blake's opinion here.
I really like that.
What Blake is a parsha unto itself. But so just framing this question though again, why does Milton represent Satan in such a positive fashion? Right. I mean, that's what critics ask. And how do you deal with it? And if you say Milton is writing a poem with a pedagogical purpose, and he really does mean what he says. Right? Blake's is a kind of Freudian reading. He didn't know it. Really, if you get Milton on the couch, you know that Milton's really, he's really of the devil's party. But let's take him at his word. If you take him at his word, well, how does it work that he represents Satan the way that he does? What is he doing? Isn't this a misinformed way of writing the poem? Isn't he giving too much weight to the satanic point or to the satanic perspective? Yeah, Alana.
I think that you have to give weight to evil if you're going to make good that much better.
Right.
It's not an interesting conflict if bad is defeated before it even starts. So if you create a devil that's worth reckoning with, then the victory over him is even that much better.
Okay. So there's some sense in which this is part of Milton's pedagogy, how does that work for us as readers? Let's read part of the passages that somebody just mentioned, this building up of Satan. Nick Tikva just mentioned it.
May I one sentence, please?
You can have one sentence.
Okay.
Don't worry Satan, so much. Go for it. Go for the whole thing.
Okay. Satan is so relatable because that's the best villains are the ones that we could become. That is why, like, we see ourselves in Satan, and that is why Satan is evil, because we could become Satan.
Satan comes off as very human sometimes, which I think why he gets some of the best lines, because we like Tikva said, we see ourselves in him, in the way he speaks, and in everything about him. He comes off as very human, which I think is ironic, because he's supposed to stand against humanity, in a sense.
Yes,
or at the very least, lead humanity astray.
We are our own worst enemies.
Yeah, okay.
Primarily is not about teaching delight, and mostly about justify the ways of God to men. But there is an element of entertain. Like, he's a poet after all, and what he's doing is very pleasing, very agreeable to the reader. Yeah, see.
But maybe if you've experienced too much delight, you'll miss the whole point of the poem.
What?
I said, maybe if you experience too much of the delight that Satan represents, doesn't that endanger the pedagogical message of the poem? I mean, that's very interesting that you bring up this. Milton is teaching and delighting, like Sidney or Aristotle would say. It seems a little strange to say of Milton. Going back to,
isn't that C.S. Lewis's exact argument? That because he represents Satan in such a willful and passionate manner, therefore the reader is able to understand the persuasiveness of Satan, how dangerous Satan is.
I see. C.S. Lewis being an early and very... C.S. Lewis is one of the critics who really wants to turn this into an orthodox poem, and he does a lot He does a lot of cleanup work in order to do that. Here, if you want to think of Satan in those human terms, here's a 19th century engraver, Gustave Doré, and you see the way he sees Satan through the lens of the human, not only the human, but the heroic human. And we do relate to Satan's suffering, to his pain. And maybe we relate to his rebellion as well. As we mentioned together as undergraduates, it's just important to mention this again, I think. Satan, through Paradise Lost, especially Book 1 and 2, is seen through a generic lens of revenge tragedy. What's our favorite revenge tragedy? Hamlet. What happens in revenge tragedy? Somebody's daddy gets killed, and there has to be revenge. So Satan looks like this revenge figure. And very often when we see him through that lens of revenge tragedy, it carries the way we see Satan is impacted by the baggage that the genre takes with it. The baggage of the genre is this character is justified in killing off the father figure, right? Without the Freudian overtones, he is the justified rebel. He has justification. He has nothing else.
Except that there's no one killed. He is avenging himself and his own rebellion. Doesn't that kind of
okay? Good. No, I hear that, and you know my tendency is to look at. I'll do the scholarly autobiography thing here, which I told you my teacher was Stanley Fish for Milton. And it just happened serendipitously that he was visiting Columbia from Johns Hopkins. He was like the hottest thing, the hottest literary critic. And it was just this amazing thing to be studying Milton with Fish, because he was an absolutely brilliant critic. And he had a very particular manner about him, which I kind of found appealing. I mean, I grew up in an upper middle class background, Long Island Jewish, and Fish, he always spoke about professionalism, but he seemed like he could have been one of my father's colleagues in the jewelry business, right? He just had the same kind of attitude about him. Did you ever see him or hear him? He treated literary criticism in this very business-like way, which was just very appealing to me at the time. Anyway, Fish came on the scene, and he wrote this book called Surprised by Sin. And his was this literary critical or literary theoretical way of saving Milton for the orthodox angelic camp. How does Milton work? Milton gives us, it sounds a little bit like what Nathaniel just said about C.S. Lewis. Milton gives us these images of Satan, which are appealing to us as readers, only to catch us out and say, see, you made the mistake. You identified with the wrong character in the poem. you're supposed to identify maybe with Jesus or Eve later on in the poem, but you're identifying with Satan. That's why his book is called Surprised by Sin. What's what's for me, and we'll see some of the passages that he bases his reading on. For me, what's unsatisfying about that reading is that the poet becomes this figure who's scolding the reader all the time. You misread. You did the wrong thing. And I think a lot of Paradise Lost is also about not only the responsibility of reading, but the responsibility of representation, the poet's responsibility in this, what he's meant to do. And also, since the poet has that responsibility, he risks certain things. He risks certain representations. Anyway, I as you can see, even as I'm representing this, there's a lot to be said for Fish's approach. Fish's approach basically is, all those parts that you're really tempted by, the reason you're really tempted by them is that's what the author, Milton, wants. He wants you to be tempted and then to fall. And the sin is of the book, which is entitled Surprised by Sin, is not the sin of Adam or Eve. It's not the sin of Satan. It's the sin of the reader. And the poet is standing there and saying, aha, see? You identified with Satan. Yes, what did I mention?
You mentioned about how it's how retelling is a story of repentance, of tshuva. And could that not be said of Satan as kind of a story of failed repentance? That we see ourselves in Satan in that he is missing this divine connection and he just misses it entirely.
I think the model would be Dr. Faustus in Marlowe's play. Remember the end of Dr. Faustus? He's like trying to repent, but he just can't. So I think it's probably one of the models as well. Let's look at this some of the passages in which you can see why critics have argued for so long. Here we're once again describing Satan. Let's see what lenses Milton or the poet holds up for us here. At which, this is line 541, at which the universal host upsent a shout that tore hell's conclave. And beyond frighted the reign of chaos and old night. All in a moment through the gloom were seen 10,000 banners rise into the air with orient colors waving. With them rose a forest huge of spears and thronging helms appeared. Oh, this is great, I didn't see this before. And serried shields in thick array of depth immeasurable. See what Milton is doing with serried here? Have we seen that before? We just did in the metaphor earlier. Am I wrong about that? Didn't we see serried before?
No, it was sedge. I think it was sedge.
It was sedge, really? Oh, okay. Serried only appears once? Oh, okay, you're right. Bad me. Okay, and thronging helms appeared in serried shields and thick array of depth immeasurable. Anon, they move in perfect phalanx to the Dorian mood of flutes and soft recorders, such as raised to height of noblest temper heroes, all arming to battle. And instead of rage, deliberate valor breathed, firm and unmoved with dread of death to flight or foul retreat, not wanting power to mitigate and swage. With solemn touches, troubled thoughts, and chase anguish and doubt and fear and sorrow and pain from mortal or immortal minds. I read that. I did not read that properly. Let's read that again. So what happens up to line from up into line 555 or line 54? What lens is Milton holding up for us?
Religion.
What classical lens? What literary lens?
Greek, Roman.
Yeah, Greek. I mean,
in the article, the epic.
Dorian specifically.
So the epic lens, Plato refers to the Dorian mode, the warlike mode, right?
Also biblical.
But then it changes in 550. Deliberate valor breathed, firm and unmoved, with dread of death to flight or foul retreat. not wanting power to mitigate and swage with solemn touches, troubled thoughts and chase anguish and doubt and fear and sorrow and pain from mortal or immortal minds. Thus, a breathing united force with fixed thought move on in silence to soft pipes that charmed their painful steps or the burnt soil. The power of poetry to relieve pain. And now, advanced in view, they stand a hard front of dreadful length and dazzling arms in guise of warriors, old with ordered spear and shield, awaiting what command their mighty chief had to impose. He, through the armed files, darts his experienced eye and soon traverse the whole battalion, views their order due, their visages and stature as of gods. Their number last he sums, and now his heart distends with pride and hardening in his strength glories. That's Exodus, right? That's Pharaoh. We're seeing his heart distending and strengthening. For never since created man met such embodied forces named with these could merit more than small infantry, warred on by cranes, though all the giant brood of Phlegra with the heroic race were joined, that fought at Thebes and Ilium, right? So now we're in Homer territory, Ilium, on each side mixed with auxiliary gods. And what resounds in fable or romance of Uther's son, Arthur, begirt with British and Armoric knights, and all who since baptized or infidel jousted at Aspromont or Montalban, Damasco or Morocco or Trebizond, of whom Bisertus sent from Afric's shore, when Charlemagne with all his peerage fell by Font Arabia. Milton's throwing the kitchen sink here, right? Greeks, Latins, Spanish, French, thus far, these beyond compare of mortal prowess. This is a typical Miltonic passage. If you were undergraduate, so I'd ask you on the final exam, how is it that Milton combines the tendencies of iconoclasm and or how can Milton both be iconoclast and poet? How does he pull it off? And here would be, this would be a good passage to bring in your answer or in your essay. Thus far, these beyond compare of mortal prowess.
Because you need to understand why it's wrong in order to find out why it's right, why what he's saying is right.
What's the it here?
Like how you asked, how can he be an iconoclast and be a poet at the same time?
Right.
So you have to see the image and understand why it's wrong in order to become the iconoclast and understand why that's correct.
Because
if you just jump to the iconoclastic mentality, then you don't understand the image, and you have to understand it before you can break it.
I think Milton would say that, well, the ultimate iconoclast would be silent and would certainly not be a poet. And maybe I'll just adopt a little bit of what Estelle said. Thus far, these beyond compare of mortal prowess. What has Milton just spent 150 lines doing? Comparing Satan to all of these things. So it's Milton really gets to have his iconoclastic cake and eat it too. Meaning on the one hand, he gives us image after image after image after image. And what does he say at the end? Thus far, these beyond compare of mortal prowess. Whatever I'm trying to describe is beyond everything that I just told you about. So Milton gives you the images. It really is like a self-consuming artifact, and kind of pulls them away from you. If you think you saw Satan, you didn't, yet never saw. So one more time. Thus far, these beyond compare of mortal prowess, yet observed their dread commander. He, above the rest in shape and gesture proudly eminent, stood like a tower. His form had yet not lost all her original brightness, nor appeared less than archangel ruined, and the excess of glory obscured, as when the sun new risen looks through the horizontal misty air. Sorry, guys. As when the sun new risen looks through the horizontal misty air, shorn of his beams, where from behind the moon and dim eclipse, disastrous twilight sheds on half the nations, and with fear of change perplexes monarchs. Darkened so, yet shone above them all the archangel, but his face, deep scars of thunder had entrenched and care set on his faded cheek. But under brows of dauntless courage and considerate pride, waiting revenge, cruel his eye, but cast signs of remorse and passion to behold the fellows of his crime, the followers, rather, for other once beheld in bliss, condemned for now, ever now to have their lot in pain. Millions of spirits for his fault immersed of heaven, and from heaven's splendors flung for his revolt. Yet, faithful how they stood, their glory withered. Wow, that was a long passage. How is Milton, how is he using these generic lenses? And are there aspects of the classical lens, the lens through which Satan is this heroic figure, is it countered by anything? Meaning, is there any sense in which as a reader we see any other narrative other than the one that Satan himself is living out? Meaning Satan, we see Satan as this author to himself, even though he's troubled. He is really represented by Milton as a kind of classical hero. I haven't.
But in his own eyes, he's a classical hero in his own eyes.
So that's my question, though. See, is there any other perspective available to us as readers? Tekva, yeah.
All these metaphors that are being used, on one hand, they are the. Oh, I can't scroll on your screen. They are metaphors of heroes, but they're also metaphors of destruction. When he talks about standing like a tower, to me at least, as someone who's learned too much Bible, like that's immediately throws me to the Tower of Babel, which fell. And then he talks about, you know, being like the sun, which is eventually destroyed in, I think it's Sophania.
You're pushing a little hard there, but I do like what you're saying. I do like what you're saying about that, about the tower that might bring to mind the Tower of Babel, of Babel maybe.
Right, and also like Yerov, when he says that like he felled all these people, he's like Yerovam ben Nevat, Chatav
Yehudi Rabin. Wait.
So whatever. There's good.
You know,
there's a lot of metaphors.
We always want to put those filters on, but let's stay close to the text first, okay? I mean, so I think when you may remember when you were undergraduates with me, we read this and we called attention to that one word, ruined. Thus far, these beyond compare of mortal prowess yet observed their dread commander. He above the rest in shape and gesture proudly eminent, stood like a tower. And Mihir, his form had not yet lost all her original brightness. So, I mean, we do have the sense that, again, we're seeing Satan in his glory, but at the end of the story, he will lose that brightness. Well, his form had yet not lost all her original brightness. Sorry, I missed that. Why is he still glowing a little bit? Why had he not lost her original brightness?
He's an archangel?
It's intrinsic.
Right, he just fell like 5 minutes ago, or not so long ago. His form had not yet lost all her original brightness, nor appeared less than archangel ruined, and the excess of glory obscured. So Fish says here, and I remember him when he taught it, you see that word ruined? That's Milton the poet hitting you over the head and saying, you've just spent 200 or 300 lines identifying with Satan. Satan, remember, also says, you know, we lost the first time, but we'll learn from experience. And we would tell Satan, even though that he's being a good Baconian and he's learning from the empirical, that as Zahavit said earlier, you're in a story that already has a predetermined ending. You're not going to change the end of the story. Meaning, and maybe this is what Tikva was also saying earlier, our admiration of Satan is not just that he's the most colorful and the strongest, but also because he's the most pragmatic. He's the most resourceful. He's the best rhetorician. And we identify with all of these characteristics, except Fish says, when that word ruin comes, the reader has a moment of reflection and realizes that he's just been identifying with Satan. You may remember from Areopagitica when we read it together, Milton's tract about politics. Let's just go to it for a second. Areopagitica. Everybody's read that, right? Pretty much. Milton says in Areopagitica, I cannot praise a fugitive and cloistered virtue, exercised and unbreathed, that never sallies out and sees her adversary, but slinks out of the race where that immortal garland is to be run for, not without dust and heat. Meaning Milton is advocating the active life. Assuredly, we bring not innocence in the world, we bring impurity much rather. That which purifies us is trial, and trial is by what is contrary. So you could say that Milton's method in Paradise Lost follows what he says in Areopagitica. A person refines themselves and purifies themselves by what is contrary. The only way you get to know good is through evil. Another passage from Areopagitica. So in some sense, and I like working with Fish, but I'm also really unhappy with him for some reason. In Fish's rendering of Milton, he's teaching you how to read, meaning you misread and you misread and you misread. And then when ruin, and then when the word ruin comes along, the narrative of Satan's own self-sufficiency becomes qualified by the narrative in which Satan is an archangel ruined. That is what Zahavit spoke about earlier. He's already in the story. From the perspective of the end of the story, on the other side of the Red Sea, he is ruined. Yet we have this experience of him, as it were, in narrative time, where we admire him. And ruin comes along, and I like this narrative term better. I want to think about why. In narrative terms, we see, oh, there are competing stories here. There's the story that Satan is telling, and where, I mean, in the and the epic narrator is helping him, and we're intrigued by him. We're intrigued by the figure of Satan, but then the word ruined comes along and says, no, there's a different narrative frame. There's a providential narrative frame in which Satan is not seen as this giant tower character, but rather is a character about whom we already know from the very beginning. To one greater man. Chaya, did you have, Chaya's family is talking to her. Dana, do you have a comment?
Yes. So I wanted to say that it's similar to what we saw in his poems. Because he tries to beat down his precursors, the classical, by sort of channeling them into Satan. And then we know that Satan is going to lose. So it's sort of...
So you're saying the classical associations not only ennoble Satan, meaning the Homeric and Virginian lens not only says, oh, what a great character, it also by definition adds a little bit of distance. That's interesting. Yeah. Never thought of that.
Yeah.
Can you repeat what you said before?
You crack me up. See, I got to tell you. I don't know what I said before.
I mean, when the ruin comes along, like in media stress, we think that Satan is the...
I'm just saying, ruined is a word from a different story. Satan, from the point of view of his own story, is not ruined. It's like suddenly the divine narrative is asserting itself. The narrative, the providential unconscious is lifting up its head.
You like that metaphor, C, or is that just confusing things worse? You're going with it. Yeah, Nathaniel.
Given that Satan essentially seems to be the ultimate misreader, then the ultimate bad reader, he totally misunderstands what's happening around him and what his role in it is. Is it then, do you kind of end up with that pedagogical message anyway of Milton standing there saying, no, 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 to the reader, this is what happens if you are a bad reader. You end up totally misunderstanding and missing the picture.
Yeah, good. Ben, what were you going to, you're about to say something?
No, I'm just taking it all in.
I mean, Fish is very satisfying to deal with this part of the poem. But it seems very, very ungenerous to me.
May I?
Oh, Tikva. Yes, please.
I think, to me, we're saying that what you've been saying is that the ruined suddenly, or what Fish is saying is that the ruined suddenly makes us realize, oh, we don't want to be Satan. But if in the Christian idea, as I understand it, which might not be, okay, whatever. In any case, that we are born impure, then wouldn't the ruined make us identify even more with Satan because he is impure like we are?
Yeah, I mean, but I mean, Satan's destiny, if we know from the very beginning of the poem, is he is the devil. I mean, you know, I mean, I thought you were going to say, well, Christian, the representation of Satan. I mean, Milton's representation of Satan is not like we would expect to see in a medieval poem, in which Satan would be red and have horns. Milton's Satan is an amenable Satan. Milton's Satan is somebody who you might want to go out for a drink with. That's the Satan that Milton, Tikva, you don't want to go out for a drink with Satan. Who here would like to go out for a drink with Satan? I mean, it depends where, I guess, right?
It sounds like there'd be consequences.
Your place or mine, right?
Who's mine?
Right. I mean, Satan is, he's good company. Remember...
But he's blind. He doesn't see who he is.
Okay. I think you're giving much. I think you're. I don't know if people are familiar with the metaphor of being overly from, overly religious. I think your reading of Milton is much too from here, meaning, I mean, for me, I identify with Satan. He seems like the coolest character in the poem.
Oh, he's definitely the coolest character.
Okay. Well, you know.
But that doesn't mean that I want to be friends with him. I mean, there are characters that are great characters and terrible people.
Tom, did you want to weigh in on this?
Yeah, what was it, Jim?
Do you want to go to a bar with Satan?
No. Oh, yeah.
No, I'm asking in general about the strat. What do we make of Milton's choice of representing Satan in the way that he does? Is he of the devil's party? Is he more, you know, just how do we deal with Satan? That's really just what I'm asking.
Aren't those very different questions?
It comes to mind from Josephus.
Oh my gosh.
He's writing Josephus for the house of what, Flavian, right? The Caesars.
Okay.
But he needs permission to his war of the Jews, right? The Jewish wars or his, and he kind of has to make a case to the Caesar because he's going to end up praising his own people, I mean, the Jewish men. But he seems to convince Caesar that in doing so, he's increasing Caesar's greatness, right? Because the greater foe that you've defeated, you are. So I think it makes sense if you read Milton, you know, straight linear at his own word, that he's seeking to justify God and to prove God's ultimate by making Satan the greater foe and enemy, it sort of achieves that end better.
It's giving, I think somebody said a version of this earlier, but it is giving a reality to evil.
Isn't that a rather heretical view though for someone like Milton?
What's the heresy?
The there would be a need to increase Satan's powers and evils in order to make God's victory seem greater.
Yes, yes, Alon, and then I have another question to ask you.
All of this comparisons to classical literature, to the classical hero, isn't that also, in a way, we know those civilizations have fallen?
You know, so that, Milton is writing a Christian epic, and he's surpassing the classics in every way. Here's my next question. Is Satan real?
Of course he's real.
What kind of real?
That's because he's in your head doesn't mean he isn't real?
Basically. I mean, Satan certainly exists as a concept and certainly has influence on our world. I think the question of whether Satan actually exists is not a very interesting one.
Oh my God. Did you just say I asked an uninteresting question?
I mean, doesn't it matter who you ask? I mean, depending on who you ask, Satan is more real or not.
Do you believe in angels?
It's a Mesopotamian. it got into Judaism from Mesopotamia. So
I think they ask Americans. I think like 85% of Americans believe in angels.
How divine!
How divine! It's fascinating to learn, but I wasn't actually asking the personal question. I was asking from Milton. I want to know what is the stat. Maybe it is a personal question, but does Satan exist?
I think so.
I mean, the obvious answer is duh. He's in the whole poem, right?
At the very least, he's a concept real enough to write about.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Estelle, what did you say?
No, but then I want to ask then again, in what sense do you mean exist? Because clearly exists if he's writing about in his poem, but does Milton necessarily believe in him? Is a different question.
He seems to suggest he exists in many different ways, right? Like all these lenses, all these forms.
Right.
That's kind of the point, is he's so multiplicitous or...
I guess another way of asking the question is evil real or not? And I know I'm asking questions that philosophers would like, you know, take me out and lynch me for, but you're a literary critic. Is evil real?
It has to be real, because if we wouldn't know what evil is, we wouldn't know what good is. Like,
it's kind of like the tiger poem.
That's the areopagitica argument.
What's the tiger poem? Tiger, tiger, burning bright?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That God is also good and evil.
Right. Well,
right. Is there actual bad, or is there just our not understanding what is going on?
We do know, right, that, and we mentioned this, maybe we didn't talk about it together recently. The problem with theodicy, justifying the ways of God to men, is of course having to deal with evil or suffering. And one of the ways that some of the early church fathers dealt with it was by saying, not the church fathers, but people who were rejected, they said there are two forces in the world. Meaning, we don't want to give God responsibility for evil because he's all good. So we will create, in order to solve that problem, we'll create, you know, another force that is responsible for evil. But the problem that you run into is that you have solved the problem of God's goodness, but you've now compromised God's all-powerfulness.
Sovereignty,
right?
Yeah.
Right? So you gain something, but you lose something else. So that's kind of behind my question of evil. Is it real? Is evil real? And I
that's why Satan's, you need to emphasize Satan's agency, because if he lacks agency, then you impute the evil to God.
Right. Remember that God says, you know, you think you're going to bring evil out of my good, but all the evil is just going to go on your head three times over. Right. Milton's playing fast and loose there because he wants to there give Satan complete agency. So evil is not the responsibility of the divine, but it's kind of like he's flirting with the Manichaean there in a way. Because in Paradise Lost, you know what I mean by saying that he's flirting with the Manichaean? He's like flirting with the idea that there is an independent force of evil in the world.
Well, there is. It's us.
That might be the end of the Devar Torah, but the Devar Torah goes on for 647 hours before we get there, right?
Yeah, I mean, I took the easy bit of doing a Machshavat unit in high school.
Okay. Thank you for sharing. Yes, Alana.
Isn't it possible that that it connects to his idea of free will? Mm. I mean, that's the whole poem. We found it in different places and in other writings of his, that he's talking about free will. Do we have free will to make decisions, even if everything is planned out ahead of time?
Right, so a good question would be is, why aren't we just like Satan? Why aren't we just why aren't we just like characters in a story in which our roles have already been determined for us?
How do you know we're not?
You Twilight Zone music. Do you know that? No?
Rod Sterling.
Of us are evil. And some of us can't repent.
That's a different question.
Ilana's never too late. I'm just kidding. that's part of the question.
We are much more like Satan because we live in real world, world of suffering.
Right. So I think to the extent that it goes back to the question of theodicy, to the extent that Milton is writing a genuine theodicy, then evil is real and therefore Satan is real. But I think on some level, and I've been thinking about Milton for years and years and years, just like the metaphors that Milton uses are incommensurable or incommensurate with what they are representing, meaning they always fall short. You're with me so far? Just like the metaphors that Milton uses are always falling short of what they want to represent. So when I see the leaves on the Italian landscape, I see Satan, I do, but I know in some sense I'm not really seeing him. Just as on the micro level, that's true. Ready for this? All of Paradise Lost, poetry as commentary, is proclaiming its own falling short in relationship to what it wants to represent. And even the story that Milton is telling, or maybe especially the story that Milton is telling, even though he himself is giving it this status in which he's almost like a prophet, itself is merely commentary on the divine. And when I say, are you with me? So this is like very hard for 7 o'clock at night.
Yeah, you said it in the video, but can you just elaborate more?
But the merely is the merely of Hillary Putnam's enough may not be everything, but enough is enough. That's all there is. Poetry is commentary. Milton's poetry is commentary on the divine. And you don't get the part enough. The metaphor is never everything, but it's maybe enough.
I'm going to have to ask you about this later because
you can ask me about it now.
But the metaphor is kind of everything because metaphors do what logical arguments can't. They can hold the complexity of life in a way that
that
logic cannot.
Metaphors are made up of similarity and difference.
Right.
Right. And it's the knowledge of the difference which makes, as I said this also, which makes poetry superior. Why should it be superior to other disciplines if it acknowledges its own insufficiency? Meaning, let's be like scientists, where we say with certainty, we know what we know. But scientists are limited in what they can know. They do know what they know, but they cannot provide the commentary on the divine that poets do. And anyone who comes along with a commentary on the divine and says, I'll tell you what it is. This is the definitive interpretation once and for all, is writing what we call bad theodicy. A theodicy that is aspiring to the perspective of the divine when we're only human.
and metaphors are the means through which humans can express what they can. But and the but for Milton is, yet never saw. Or the but for Milton is, yeah, I just described 25 things and the devils are not comparable to them. You just showed me. That was how you tried to describe them to me. Yes, because that's what's at hand. That's what I can give you. But never think that's complete. And from this perspective, just to go back, the poem itself as a commentary on the divine is as a commentary on the divine, in some sense, evil does not exist. Satan does not exist. Of course he doesn't exist. It's a story. It's a fairy tale.
Stories are true.
It's a fairy tale.
But there's a reason fairy tales stick with us, and that's because they hold truth within them.
But we don't want to believe in when we believe in fairy tales after childhood, we are showing that we are children. Adults should not believe in fairy tales. People, we don't need to live. People who live out fairy tales want to live in an enchanted world. A world that's forever enchanted. The devils live in an enchanted world. A world that's conjured. A world in which everything is, in which we conjure the world in such a way that we forget our own helplessness and vulnerability. That's what fairy tales do to us.
Ah, I see. That kind of fairy tale.
Yeah, that kind of fairy tale.
Yeah, but adults are constantly and continuously engaged in fairy tales from Game of Thrones to Swan Lake, whatever you want. There are tons of them.
Right.
They have so many.
Culture.
How about the I Know What God Wants Me to Do fairy tale?
Well, okay, so stories have different kinds of functions. And you know what? It is a fairy tale. But Milton's Paradise Lost is a commentary on that fairy tale. Does that make sense? We can hear you.
Esther, yeah. I need you to repeat your last five minutes.
You can rewatch it. I'll say it. I'll try to. I'll say that last part, which I liked a lot. I already forgot it. See, what did I say? That poetry. That the story that Milton tells is a fairy tale. Wow. But Paradise Lost itself, that's the commentary is what's interesting. I'll say now, and this is something really heretical, do not record this. The Bible, the written Torah, do not say this, is the fairy tale. Torah Shebal Peh, that's the story. Midrash is the story.
Well, yeah.
And therefore, is there a correlate to the fairy tale in reality? Of course not. Who would think that?
Of course there is.
I'm saying, is there Satan? That's what I'm talking about. Does Satan exist? So on some level, that the metaphor of the pilot, that at the second lecture, says, you bet he does. Because that poor pilot who's thrown the anchor into the scale of the Leviathan, he's screwed because there is a such a thing as evil. It may be in some later point of view, that Satan becomes who he is, stretched out like a monster on the road. But to that guy at that moment, yeah, evil is real. For me, the question, is Satan real? Is answered by the pilot's experience, by his experience. Yes, he's real.
You've lost
and the Leviathan figure of the evil Satan, I don't know if that's the fairy tale. But that's the metaphor that Milton is using. I'm just saying, the same analysis that we did on that Red Sea metaphor, you can do with the whole poem. The whole poem is just a lens through which to look at the sacred or the spiritual.
Dust can never be perfect?
Never can be perfect, because we're always... Right. Yeah, go ahead. Dana, go ahead.
No, but he meant to say, it's like, it sort of resonates Da Vinci, who said that art is never finished, only abandoned. So through these metaphors, we can see only what he channels, not the whole.
Because there's because an artist who thinks he's going to, or is going to present a perfect representation, will make paintings that people hang up, you know, like, it's like people in my neighborhood will hang up bad art, right? Sometimes there is a disjunction between, well, I forget about it. Do you trust people who have bad taste? No.
No.
What do you mean by bad taste?
What do you mean by trust?
Well, you see, remember William Barr, the Attorney General of the United States, he was being examined in Congress by Kamala Harris. And he said, what do you mean by the word suggest? He was like squirming, right? We can do like every single word.
This is what happens when we start philosophy in class.
Yeah,
that's why definitions are important.
What do we mean by good taste? Oh, come on, Tikva, you have when you have good taste, you know it.
It depends what I trust them for. Do I trust somebody who's really good at fixing my toilet, plumber who doesn't have good taste? Yeah, I trust them to fix my toilet.
Okay, good. Excellent. Right. Now I was just raising the question about the relationship between virtue and aesthetics.
So is evil an issue of taste? Is that what we're...
No, we're not. No.
It certainly is.
Well, in a post-Miltonic word or whatever, and once the 18th century kicks in, then taste becomes the means of being chosen. That's what Joseph Addison does in The Spectator. Being chosen is not being spiritually chosen, it's being chosen, you have a person of good taste, refinement, manners, right? It's softening religious fundamentalism with good manners. And we could all use a little bit of that, right?
Religious fundamentalism.
I've had enough of that, thanks.
Are you happy now? C is completely in the dark. Oh, there he is. He's emerging from the dark.
I'm really out. It's just... I'm in the dark mentally also.
Let's read the last lines of book one, and then we'll go home. Let's see. Okay, last lines. They build pandemonium, which is a cool scene, right? Let's read the very end. Okay, so the whole, all of book one is it just describing Satan? So thick, and the Satanic Host, so thick, 775. So thick, the airy crowd swarmed and were straightened till the signal given. Behold, a wonder. They but who now seemed in bigness to surpass Earth's giant suns, now less than smallest dwarves. So they're bees up above. And then they're transformed. So thick the airy crowd swarmed and were straight until the signal given. Behold, a wonder. They but now who seemed in bigness to surpass Earth's giant suns, now less than smallest dwarves in narrow room. Throng numberless like that pygmyan race beyond the Indian mount. Are the devils big and strong and threatening or not?
Not anymore.
No.
Yes.
Yes, no, yes, no, right, back and forth. In narrow room, throng numberless like, how are they both, Tikva?
Like electrons are, like, it's...
Oh my God, they're both a wave and a particle at the same time?
Exactly.
So from what perspective are they a wave, and from what perspective are they a particle?
They are great in power, but small in, what's the word? Perception? And like their perception of the world.
I thought you were going to slam dunk it, Tifa. You went halfway. You did a layup. It was good. I would say, from their own perspective, they're giant. From the providential's perspective, they're pygmies. And Milton keeps on shifting those narrative lenses. Or there you go again, fairy elves, whose midnight revels by a forest side or fountain some belated peasant sees, or dreams he sees. While o'er the head the moon sits arbitrous, and nearer to the earth wheels her pale course, they on their mirth and dance intent with joke on music charm his ear. So this last metaphor, it's a little bit like that earlier one on the Red Sea, where seeing the image not through a telescope here, but through the it's like here again, Milton is saying, oh, I want to show you what the devils look like. Imagine a peasant and he's dreaming, or dreams he sees, meaning instead of telling you, this is what it is, here it is, it's being mediated through the peasant and he's not even seeing it, he's dreaming about it. So from that point, well, so from that point of view, right, that Milton is insisting on the separation more and more between the image and what it's ostensibly about. I know we're finishing now. At once, with joy and fear, his heart rebounds. Thus, incorporeal spirits, to smallest forms, reduce their shapes immense, and were at large. See that Milton plays with it in these two lines. Smallest forms, reduce their shapes immense, and were at large, though with number still amidst the whole of that infernal court. But far within, and in their own dimensions, like themselves. That's a great metaphor, right? But far within and in their own dimensions, like themselves. It's a simile. What are they like? They're like themselves. The great seraphic lords and cherubim in close recess and secret conclave sat, 1,000 demigods on golden seats, frequent and full. After short silence, then summons read. The great consult began. Is Satan real? At the end of book one, he sure is, right? It's so interesting that Milton is metaphor after metaphor after metaphor, simile after simile, and then he says they're like themselves in their own dimensions. After short silence, then in summons read, the great consult began.
Why is that weird?
I don't know. I'm just struck by the exalted nature of the verse at the end, and how after all of these different metaphors, and especially the one previous in which it's Satan, the metaphor that comes earlier is almost suggesting in its removal that this thing, if Satan has a reality, we certainly can't know it. It's so much at a remove from us. And then Right. Boom, in your face, there's Satan. In this material sense, this majestic sense, exalted. Okay, I feel badly now. I should feel like I should make you coffee during this thing. You've had a really, really long day, and I'm really once again going to congratulate you on being the heroes of the university. It is not the administrators. It is not the professors. It is certainly not the president of the university. But here we are, the heroes of the university. So please take a bow. Take your gold medal, have a nice meal, and feel good about being here. Is there any interest in me doing, when is, Yom HaZikaron is on Tuesday, Yom HaTzmud is on Wednesday? So we have no class next week. Do you have classes on Sunday and Monday? And you have classes on Thursday? You must have class on Sunday and Monday, right?
I have class on Monday.
Yeah. There is one.
Our schedule's different.
Also, people work on days.
So maybe I'll do something on Tuesday and Thursday, an optional thing, a short thing, if people want to do. The last one on Lycidas was just super fun.
send out a link to the actual.
Can you send it to me? Because I didn't get the invitation for this.
I have a YouTube channel, guys. You can watch all my videos there. I'm just saying.
I saw the video.
Just Google me. Oh, what did I not give you then?
You didn't invite us to the actual lecture.
To the Lycidas.
Oh, really?
Meeting.
I was wondering, because all these other people came to the lecture from like out of the class because I put it on Twitter and Facebook. And I was like, wow, there are more people here than from my class.
Well, no, yeah. I didn't get it either.
I must have made a mistake then. My bad.
So if you do it on Thursday, please send us an invite.
Just quick informal, Tuesday or Thursday?
Tuesday.
All right, we'll see. I'm Mozema Zigurin, as I said, we did want to respect that. Okay, guys, thanks for hanging out. Any questions? I'll hang out for a little while longer. I'll make believe I'm getting my books together. I'm going to just get some more water. But for the rest of you, have a good vacation, a good week, and I'll speak to you. Yeah? Stay safe, stay healthy, and sane.
Have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Professor, what are we going to do about...
Let's see.
I think he's out, right? No?
It's just you and me.
Are you sure about it? Let's see how many people here. No, there's a lot of people here.
Really?
Yeah, you can see the but they are exiting by the moment.
It's almost as if the lecture ended, see.
I'm having the best chocolate cookie now. So what's up?
Professor, what would you recommend to somebody that feels behind, that feels out of sorts?
I would say that you're a true Miltonist. The true thinker. Oh, we're having fun now. See, we're doing we're having conversations about Milton that most classes never really get to, you know. So if we're left with uncertainty or questions, it's because we're exploring. I mean, the thing is, we should definitely make sure that the fairy tale version of the class is accessible and available. Just continuing our metaphor, meaning we should make sure we have a basic sense of what's going on in Paradise Lost. But I'm pretty sure in the next 5 or 6 weeks, or however many weeks we have left, we will have that. But I am happy to review any of the things that seem more crucial to just having a working understanding of the problems of reading Paradise Lost. We're moving past that in our discussion by trying to maybe answer some of those questions. Which, what I mean by is like the relationship between humanism and Puritanism, classicism and iconoclasm, free will and determinism, good and evil, free choice. You know, we're going to be talking about these things for the next few weeks. So when I went off, as I did, you know, talking about metaphor and fairy tale, that's based upon all of our close readings. And just taking some risks, which I'm taking risks is built into teaching, right? And we're taking them. And, you know, part of your responsibility, and you're doing that now, is to, you know, ask. But also part of it is to understand, see, and you should know this better than anybody, the winner of the Rector's Prize for being a great student, that, you know, you can't always know everything all the time. That you're happy to be stuck with questions. That's really the world we live in. Not, enough is not everything, but enough is enough. I know sometimes we're frustrated because we have a sense of the everything on the horizon, which we think we might be getting, but we're not getting fully. And you know what? Perfection should always be on the horizon as a possibility that you'll never reach. But it shouldn't be the thing that intimidates you into thinking that you don't know anything.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you see any parallels between Iago and the devil?
I haven't read Othello in a long time, and I'm sure that's true.
I kind of feel like that there are parallels between the two characters.
Well,
and perhaps the situation even.
I think Shakespeare, you know, just like in Measure for Measure, where Shakespeare will use stock characters from like medieval drama and allegory and complicate them, I think Iago is also part of his genetic code. I like that. Part of his generic genetic code is the figure of the devil from earlier medieval genres. So it makes sense then to see it go through to Satan and to Milton.
And I remember my teacher, when I was studying it, my teacher pointing out that he gives many contradictory reasons for his motivation. Mm-hmm. And basically, he doesn't really have any motivation except for to do evil, you know, sort of.
Right, whatever. Tom, you said just sort of. Yeah, I mean, we're not reading Othello, but we have to read it. We have to put Othello on our reading list, right?
Okay. Yeah. Would that be something I could write something like that for
sure.
The course? Yeah.
We should talk about it more, but absolutely, yes.
Okay.
Any other comments or questions? Chaya, then Tikva.
You made us.
Oh, it's Tom. Chaya, Tikva, then Tom. And then we'll go, and then we'll eat dinner. Yeah. Chaya, you're on mute again, Chaya.
Oops, I just want to say thank you and goodbye. Thank you.
Bye.
Stay safe.
You too.
Bye.
You'll see you around in the neighborhood. Tom, yeah. Or a tick for you first, yeah?
Yeah. I wanted to ask about the does Satan exist question. I think I may have lost the plot on that one, and I just wanted to... What were you trying to ask?
Does God exist?
I still don't know what you're asking.
It's okay. Does God exist? What am I asking? You know that Maimonides, was that Alana laughing in the background? Maimonides says in the Guide for the Perplexed that even predicating existence to God is a misrepresentation of God.
Oh, absolutely.
So saying God is a misrepresentation of the divine.
Yeah.
So I'm asking the same thing about Satan.
Well, Satan exists. I think there are...
Satan
exists as an idea in our culture. I mean, you cannot say that Satan doesn't exist because Satan has such a huge influence on our lives in some ways, whether it's people closing preschools because of the satanic panic or whatever they're doing.
But that's not. I'm not asking that. I'm asking.
Yeah, that's
right. From the point of view of Milton's perspective.
Mm. I'm not sure that Satan. I mean, but I'm not sure that the Satan in Paradise Lost is concurrent with the Satan that Milton believes in.
Okay, that's going in the right direction, I think. I mean,
I think the character and Satan, the divine being, are two very different Satans.
Right, so what is Satan, the divine being?
We can't know.
I guess the question I would want to be asked is, do you really think that there's that Maimonidean impulse in Milton? You know what I mean by that? My Maimonidean impulse. My mind is basically says you cannot predict any predication of the divine, anything. God is good. God, not only God's hand, which is obvious. That's the problem that Maimonides is dealing with. Does God really have a body? Not only that, but God is good is a predication that misrepresents the divine, because any representation of the divine will be a misrepresentation. So, what I've been saying so far is that the Miltonic poet is a secret Maimonidean. Not a secret Maimonidean.
Oh.
At the very, at the, it's crazy to say that because Milton has very different assumptions than Maimonides. But I think maybe about representation, there's a Maimonidean starting point.
Yeah. Okay.
And then Milton just said, and then Milton says, "Oh, make images, image, 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 image." But once you say that, then the question is, does Satan exist? Is the same question, of course.
Right. So Milton is in a way, and this is not a great metaphor, but he's kind of taking the Rambam one step further and becoming the Ibn Ezra, who kind of is extremely realistic, but also a poet.
Tipa, that just sounds extremely interesting, and you can I would love to hear more about it or write something about it. That's fantastic. Milton going from being Maimonides to the Ibn Ezra. It's just very, it's very.
I don't know enough about the Ibn Ezra to do that. I couldn't.
I just say it's tantalizing. Dana, did you have a comment?
I just wanted to say thank you. If you can.
Whoa. We just lost you, Dana. We can't hear you.
Right now, I have some.
We didn't hear anything you said.
Ah, okay. So I said thank you about the class, and if we can talk sometime about my thesis, that's it.
For sure, for sure. Just email me. Yeah, definitely. Maybe tomorrow.
Okay, I'm going to go help with supper. Thank you so much.
Good night, everybody. See you soon. I'm available later tomorrow. Whatever. Speak to you. Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye. Is it me now?
Oh, Tom, do you want to talk? Yeah, we're here, yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to follow up. At the beginning, you went at length to kind of distinguish Milton and, say, the philosophers. But in terms of Milton and the poets,
yeah,
I'm interested to situate and get this. I have greater blind spot ignorance. And I read an article by Hollander here recently. And he said that Milton has a much more monumental undertaking with poetry itself, rather than merely, say, the poet's creative faculty.
What, one more time?
And he's suggesting that Milton's seeking, I can just read it here, it says, it is, however, he's gone on about...
Wait a second. C is giving me an idea. So I'm going to do the same thing. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so he's just touched on how Milton's broken with the whole tradition of rhyme and Milton's unique, how does he call it, pauses or say variety of pauses, whatever, his style. But now, and he suggests that there's more going on, and I just read this sentence. It says, it is, however, this is Hollander, poetry itself, rather than poet's creative faculty, which he, Milton, specifically wishes to lead. I'm trying to get a sense of...
Read that again because you broke up a little along the way. Read it slowly. Yeah?
Okay, so he says, again, after touching on Milton's unique style, he's broken with the tradition of rhyme. So he says, it is, however, poetry itself, rather than the poet's creative faculty, which Milton specifically wished to liberate. And then he goes on to say, Ben Jonson is also in this, of the similar monumental undertaking, or the transformation of poetry itself, of the poetic form. Mm. So I'm thinking, because I think you quite clearly distinguish Milton from philosophy, the philosophers, but I'm more trying to get a sense of what Milton's trying to do with poetry, with poetic form. Like, this ep of his stands out, right? Very different, very unique from the prior tradition of poetic epic.
Oh, that makes sense. Can you hear me I think it's just like, I think Francis Bacon says that he wants to teach experience her letters, meaning he wants to move away from earlier forms of learning and constructions of learning and constructions of reality and the kinds of languages and discourses that create an ordered world, and he wants the language, the experience itself to speak. So I think Milton wants his Christian reality to speak through his poetry.
Well, and I would say it this way. I don't agree with the Blake quote. But there are two things. One is that we were all seeming of a consensus. A poet is of the devil's party, or however it's said. Yet, senses Milton is not himself. And that's because while he is a poet, he's doing, I think he's striving or seeking to do something different with the poetic form, right? He's breaking with much of the tradition or what's come before him.
Well, I mean, yes and no. I mean, I think poetry, even before Milton, has a didactic purpose, meaning, so poetry still, it's only really in the 18th century that poetry ceases to have that kind of didactic purpose. So on the one hand, I agree with you that he is liberating the form, but
Are you still there?
Yeah, no, I'm here. I'm just.
Yeah. Oh, you're.
I'm getting. Okay. I'm getting lost in thought here. I would want to know what monumental in what sense? Monumental in kind of in the literary, in the appropriation of literary form.
Just working within that context. So he suggests something was, I don't know, awry with rhyme, right? He has some quote about it's of a barbarian age, or it's the product of. And right, so he's kind of, maybe I'll put it in the simple language. He seems to be seeking to clean poetry up.
Right. He's trying to clean up.
And he's not a philosopher, or he sort of, he gets that there's something necessary in poetry that philosophy just cannot achieve, cannot possess.
Exactly.
So that's what you conveyed quite clearly, and I agree. But now where I'm uncertain is, and I'm in a similar position, my own pursuit here with poetry is like, there's something to be gained, something addedly to be possessed uniquely with poetry, through poetry, that philosophy is barren of, is impoverished of. But then there are these problematics at the same time about poetry. And it's this issue of, it's many things, but what we just said, like the poet is of the devil's party. Yet I think Milton trying to walk a certain line or strike something unique here in avoiding this tendency, this pitfall, this.
No, that's, in a way, that's what Renaissance literature is, walking that line. Sidney's walking the line. Spencer's walking the line. They're all trying to write a Protestant poetics.
If I put this more simply, it's simple language. I'm conscious and intentionally oversimplifying, but it was suggested in some of my research, Milton is a monist, and he's preserving, and he preserves and conveys a monic conception of reality and all this. So my thought is his discontents with philosophy is, in a certain sort of sense, philosophy's dualistic. It may be simple enough to say it has to be.
We're going to complicate that, because Milton really is between two poles, between Descartes and Spinoza, or between Hobbes and Spinoza. And I think, as we'll discover together, I'd like you to open up to the possibility that Milton is not a simple monist. And he's not a simple dualist either. Where Spinoza's, and I'm talking about ontology now, they're for Spinoza, there's an identity between spirit and matter, right? Milton avoids that, but he also avoids the dualism of Descartes. I'm not really even sure where you're going with this about the monistic conception of reality. I'm thinking more in terms of ontology. But I think maybe once we explore those things, it will become a little bit, maybe some of these issues you're exploring.
Well, a thought I had too, if he is, we do consider him in this monistic, is he's kind of take like the Augustinian on sin or on evil even, which is, it's like what, it's parasitic. So in that way, it's not really real. But then what you'd have to believe is, with whatever evil is in this parasitic, it's not, it's Zoroastrian dualistic form. It's not a real coinciding thing. But then what I would anticipate, and I think Milton's speaking to this, is evil then would necessarily have to have a mixed character. It's going to have to be part of the good, because it's being parasitic and how it relates to that. Yeah. I think that's his Satan, right? His figure of Satan, who we can say is figuring evil, figuring. But what we're shocked and surprised about is there's maybe a lot more of the good in Satan as there would be in evil. And there's that kind of evolutionary concept of entropy, where both Satan and all of his horde are gradually being conveyed in their ugly visage, like how they're increasingly digressing. Or so it's like, yeah, I think it's this issue that we shouldn't be disturbed by the fact that Satan more good than I'm just taking up all these different figures who have commented on that Satan's in this as his protagonist, right? He's in this somewhat
I know, Tom, you're these are fascinating questions, and I'm not, to be honest, just because it's late, I'm not following all of them. But I think I would say, just to qualify a little bit, and I will try to think about these before we meet again, is that I don't know if Satan has the appearance of goodness. I think that's I'm not so sure that Satan partakes of the good in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
Although I understand the direction you're going in. The monist direction, which would push you in that direction. I see that. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'm feeling like he is feeling right now. So you're still awake there?
Right.
One of my
say happy birthday. Bro.
I'm listening to every word, really, every instant.
It looks like you just came off a bad trip.
It's a big 3-0. Have you joined the 30s clubs?
No, I'm 29.
How much
you have? Oh, okay, you got one.
One more year, 29. All right, guys. Thanks a lot. We'll speak to you soon. Yeah, take care. Call too. Be well.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Yeah.
Bye-bye.
Just my class, Mishmar.